African cultural response to slavery and oppression in the Americas and the Caribbean began on the shores of West Africa when captured Africans tried to take African soil into their mouths and sometimes in their hands onto the slave ship. Slavery was a war against African culture, especially against the structure of the African family. Those are the words of the Honorable John Henry Clark. And Asa Hilliard's powerful piece, African Power. Our medicine and our healing is in our culture, African culture. And to it we must return if we want African black life. Indeed, we pour libation to cleanse us and connect us to our culture, to preserve and serve Ma'at. For we Africans are one, lest we forget. Libation is a custom where liquid, usually water, is poured as it represents the essence of life onto a living plant at a shrine on the ground. Indeed, in many ways, as the names of historical and familial ancestors and forces are called, the purpose is to connect the continual chain of our existence, the unborn of the spirit world, the youth, the adults, the elders, the ancestors, the loa, the forces, the cosmic forces, such that the entire community, the village, the circle of life is present, and therefore their wisdom, their strength, and their power is summoned as we move north, south, eastward to populate the globe, and even westward as a result of the great Ma'afa. Libation traveled with us. African culture traveled. Our spiritual and belief systems traveled. Our drum and dance and songs and steps, they traveled with us. And yes, our Orisha, our Abason, our Lucy Netzeloa, the ancestral and spiritual wisdom traveled and are here with us and for us now when we choose to remember again that our medicine and our healing is in our culture. And that is why libation is essential, for we lose when we cease to remember, when we throw away our ancestors with the bath water, our babies, indeed our future suffers. There is and can be no Sankofa without honoring our past as the basis for the future we seek. So honor our ancestors, honor our history, honor our way, lest we die. For in the words of Birigo Jope, just as our ears were deaf to their cries, to their wild appeals, they have left on the earth their cries for us blind, deaf, and unworthy children who see nothing of what they have made in the air, on the water. So we pour and we speak libation as our own personal and collective quest for our own self-reparation, because repairing the African spirit starts with the pouring, the speaking, the living of libation. That is its purpose. We are instructed by our ancient ancestors in the Book of Ani to pour libation for our fathers and mothers who rest in the valley of the dead. We must not forget to do this even when we have been torn away from home. For as we do for our parents or not, our children will do also for us or not. We pour and we speak libation for the indomitable fighting spirit we seek to resurrect, that we may continue our pursuit of black life, that is liberation, independence, freedom, empowerment. We dare call it justice for our ancestors and our children's future. And we pour and we speak libation in honor of those ancestors who left us a legacy worthy of honor. We pour and we speak for those who have contributed to our lives in ways we know and appreciate, and in the countless ways we have yet to understand, and in many ways we may never even know. We pour and we speak for the mother father of civilization, the nation builders, the concept creators, the freedom fighters, the warriors, the educators, those who escaped and those who stayed, those who fought and those who hid, those that roared and those that cried, those who held it down so that we may be lifted up, those who held us together so we could stand on our own. We pour and we speak for those whose struggles lay the foundation for the world's greatest diaspora, which will be great once again when we remember to love ourselves. We pour and we speak for those who have poured into us, filling us with the instincts, the insight, the intuition, the intelligence, the instruction that guide us forward, and that we will pass on to the beautiful ones not yet born. And we pour, we speak, and we live for the beautiful children not yet born, hoping that our living, our contribution to their future will one day be worthy of remembrance, respect, recognition, and reverence. And since we have your ear and we have your presence, we ask for African power, power to heal, overcome, become whole and exemplary and sovereign. Once again, Ashe, Aluta Continua, Uhuru Sasa, Black Power, Ubuntu, I am we. And we are one. So let the healing begin. Let our healing continue. Greetings and good afternoon. Welcome to Groundings with Brother Shomari. I am Brother Shomari. And Groundings with Brother Shomari comes at you on Fridays from 1 to 4 p.m. right here, WURD Radio, 96.1 FM, 900 AM on your radio. We also stream live on WURDRadio.com and Facebook Live. Is that true? Are we on Facebook Live? Facebook Live at WURD Radio. And then follow us on all of our social media platforms at ONWURD. I only asked because I saw the master technician Mike working on it when I came in, so I wanted to make sure that my statement was true. So yes, follow us on Facebook Live at WURDRadio.com. Groundings also comes at you on Sundays from 6 to 8 p.m. right here at WURD. Before we go to our elders' permission to speak, our ancestors, our forces are always at work, because I definitely came in here in a particular kind of energy and mood today, and I might still end up in that space, so I'm not going to say that I'm not. But I walked into a letter, and sometimes I got to always remember what's on or who's on the other end of what I do and whether it's important for them, when my own personal kind of feelings or intentions, you know, rear up sometimes. So I just want to read a part of this letter because it kind of helped me to woo-sigh a little bit, and we'll see where it goes. Dear Brother Shomari, God bless you for taking the time to construct and build your thinking and thought processes in a way our entire diaspora benefits from. I listen to your program often. I am never disappointed. I'll skip the part about the money. But it actually says, please take these dollars and spend them with any black businesses you so choose. I take refuge in your thoughts, and I appreciate the actions you continue to take to protect all of us. And I appreciate that. Actually, the timing of that couldn't be better, because I was definitely contemplating whether or not this actually matters in any particular way, given the reality that our people are is the reality that our people face right now. And it's something I'm going to continue to explore, because I think that we need to get it right. Wake up and fly right. Not just fly, but fly right. And we're living in a moment where there's confusion and chaos and constipation and the crossroads, and it has to be cleared out if we're going to move forward. And it stinks. The constipation is backed up bowel movement, and a lot of people who just don't deserve to be in the crossroads, particularly when we're talking about diaspora building, nation building, when we're talking about black power and liberation, because they have no pedigree or credibility in that space, are actually some of the most prominent voices and platforms in that space, and they got to be sat down. It's just clear. We have to man and woman the Urukure and clear the air, and so that the Ashe can come forward clearly. And that's a duty. It's an obligation. We know it. Those of us of clear mind and clear voice know it. And we have to stop cowering while we let the crossroads get backed up with constipated thinking, chaotic voice, and confusing ideology. So that's a call. All y'all who profess to be elders and mamas and eyes and babalao, mambo, hungan, whatever your calling is, there's a moment here that you can no longer run from. The crossroads are constipated. People with wicked intentions, unclear voice, unclear intention for us as a people are crowding the crossroads, and we're letting them have legitimacy. We're letting them have space in a place where they should not have space. They need to be delegitimized, because they're going to lead our people off of a cliff. There's a calling there for people of clear mind. So Dai, stand forward, stand up in your clear voice. Bring forward the rules, the protocols. This ain't for everybody. If you're at war, the enemy in warfare is liberalism. Not every opinion needs to be elevated to the idea of informed opinion. We need clear guidance, clear instruction, clear leadership, clear direction. It must be articulated clearly, it must be thought about clearly, and it must be acted upon clearly. Ain't a time for everybody just because they can talk to talk. Ideas are being confused right now because the crossroads are constipated. We have too many intersections in our intersectionality, and we have white liberalism policing the intersection. We have white liberalism acting as the crossing guard in our crossroads. In their own crossroads, no problem. In the Negro crossroads, no problem. In the nigger crossroads, no problem. But in the crossroads of red, black, and green, in the crossroads of African-centered consciousness, in the crossroads of black power, in the crossroads of black life, it is a supreme problem that can no longer be ignored. If you're going to play the game and nail down and bow down to white supremacy, that is cool. Just stay in your lane. Don't bring that on this side of the road. Don't throw up signs you ain't earned. I can't walk around and throwing up Greek letter fraternal signs and writing, you know, Greek letter words on my shirt and saying I'm a member of something if I did not pledge, if I was not initiated. So don't fake the funk with some red, black, and green, or now all of a sudden you on the side of uprising and nation building when you ain't pledged this side. You're going to get slapped down. This ain't nothing to play with. Too many people have lost lives.
Too many people have sacrificed too much. Too many people banging every day on behalf of black power, independence, nation building, diaspora building, for mugs who ain't put no blood, sweat, tear, or breath on this side of the game to try to come over here now and co-opt the conversation. It won't happen like that. That message has been delivered. Let's go to Reverend Joe. Greetings.
Good afternoon, Brother Shomari. I didn't want to tell you, I'm the one who wrote that letter. I used the anonymous name. No, I'm just kidding. Hey, Mark Sean, listen, I'll leave this with you real quick. I love what you're saying. We got to start telling people the truth about white supremacy, racism, and all of it, all that light and black stuff. I mixed, forget it, because the government said years ago, if you had one drop of black blood in you, you were black. So I don't get into that black and brown. Forget that brown. You black, period. And you keep on living, you're going to find out. The teachers or somebody to tell them, this is what the real deal is. I don't care what the books are saying or what you think. They're going to say, you're smart. Yeah, you're smart. If you're black, you better know what's going on. There's too many of them. Don't know what kind of weather they're flying in, and they're playing these silly games with these bougie Negroes and everybody else that's lying to us. I'm going to tell the truth till I get out of here. So that's my little speech for today. Thank you for letting me do that and spend that money. Spend that money.
I appreciate you as always, Reverend Jill, with our elders' permission to speak. And yeah, we going to get in it today. I'm going to do my best. You know, this might be my, you know, everything I do at this point. I'm clear. We don't have time to assume that we have time. That's the thing about this moment we in right now. Too many people assuming that you can plan for something that you really can. You can't assume that we're going to have the time to do the thing that you're. So the time is now. We've been sitting on it too long, and the last thing we can do right now, too much sacrifice, too much work has gone into holding a position that not everybody is man or woman enough to hold. So you don't get to come to the front of this line. It don't work like you got to pledge first. You got to provide some kazi first. Just like I can't throw up gang signs, I can't throw up Greek letter fraternity signs, I can't say I'm a Boule member and I ain't go through Boule stuff. I can't say I'm a member of the Divine Nine and I ain't done nothing nine or divine in order to do. If I did that, mugs would make me pay a price. Or at least they would try. And I'm saying, nah. Y'all, mugs have thrown shade on the idea of black nationalism and black power and black nation building far too long to all of a sudden get marching orders that say, aha, we're going to run to the front of this conversation. No, not on my watch. Now, if this might be the last time I get to say it, cool. I don't give a flying hoot about that. I'm letting you know that now. It's going to get said regardless. But this don't work like that. It's disrespectful and it's insulting. And I am saying for all of the brothers and sisters who profess to be about a certain thing, stand up. Stop letting charlatans walk over into this space that has been worked so hard to maintain when nobody else wanted to even be associated with the walk that we walk. Ain't no open invitation on this one. If you come in this way, you're going to have to earn your way in and start at the back of the line. That's like the boys coming in and running in the UNIA after he destroyed Garvey or helped to destroy Garvey. Now, he can pay his penance later. That's cool. He did. He worked a life that tried to pay penance for what he knew was a mistake. But he didn't come and try to run the UNIA. Come on, y'all. This is silly at this point. Our cowardice, our lack of principle is silly. So we're going to get straight today. Hit me up at 215-634-8065, toll free 866-361-0900. We'll talk with you after these messages.
Start your day with Daybreak.
Hosted by Helena.
Weekdays 6 a.m. till 7 a.m. Exclusively on Word Radio 96.1 FM and 900 AM WURD.
Streaming live at wordradio.com and on the Word Radio app.
AARP presents this Black Music Makers Moment. The aspirations of a focused, determined parent are powerful. In gospel music, it was Dr. Mattie Moss Clark of the Clark Sisters. Maddie Moss Clark was a legendary choir director, and her daughters Twinkie, Jackie, Dorinda, and Karen were always under her wing and guidance. That guidance and musical discipline has made the Clark Sisters the best-selling female gospel group in history.
I'm Joanne Jenkins with AARP. The coronavirus continues to affect us all, and we are here, actively supporting you and your community. Every day, we're providing trusted information from top health experts, sharing tools to help protect families from fraud, and creating resources to support family caregivers everywhere. As always, you can count on AARP to advocate for you and your family. Join us and stay connected at aarp.org/coronavirus.
AARP proudly celebrates Black Music Month.
Your child deserves to be educated in a safe learning environment. Southwest Leadership Academy Charter School is a tuition-free public school. Both our locations offer dual-gender environments with single-gender classrooms. Our students score in the top state testing percentile among area schools. Apply online at bit.ly/enrolls SLA in all caps. That's bit.ly/enroll SLA.
No fear, just facts. This is WURD, independent Black media.
Want the latest in word swag?
Check out the shop tab on wordradio.com. Hoodies, tees, and more in a variety of colors. The shop tab on wordradio.com. Show the world that you're all about Black.
Talk media.
In Pennsylvania, everyone counts, and everyone needs to participate in the census. Our population count determines our voice in government and how much federal funding our communities receive for health care, food assistance, education, transportation, housing, and more. So every infant and child, every foreign and U.S. citizen, everyone matters. For a stronger future, we all need to count. To learn more, go to pa.gov/census.
Groundings
with Brother Shomari
right now on Word Radio
and wordradio.com.
Y'all, let's dig in, because there is such a thing as a group of people who are pawns who pledge to protect the bishop. We're going to talk about it today because they've been activated. And I told y'all it was coming, and we just need to call it for what it is. My job right now is just to make clear what's going on. I play the song a lot. You know, you're going to do with it what you will. I have no control over that. I can only control how I respond and the walk I walk. in relationship to what I knew. But my Heru senses are tingling. You know, we talk about the all-seeing eye of Heru, but it's really the eye represents all of the senses by which you process inputs. I just want to read something real quick. It's a quick primer. I call it, on upcoming deflections and distractions. Please pay attention, because this is going to happen right in front of your face. It's happening now, but we don't see it. So I'm hopefully helping us see, because if we don't see it, then we act by way of superstition. And Stevie Wonder told you, superstition ain't the way. But our superstition has evolved into what I call stuperstition, where we really decided to be stupid in order to believe in stuff that we don't understand, and therefore we continue to suffer. Ah, man, I think we like suffering. I think we're masochistic that way. I think we've been reduced, grafted, genetically modified, if you will, to really become this black, what I call black nihilist masochist. The idea of black death and suffering has been so embedded in our brain that we really begin in a perverse way to enjoy that role. And our protest is not in the name of power, it's that we're protesting that white supremacy has not seen our sacrifice, our offering, as worthy. So they continue their death cult. We've offered up sacrifice after sacrifice in the name of Moloch. And white supremacy has not found any of those sacrifices worthy, so they continue to devour. And we protest because we're saying, wait, we've given you our young boys. We've given you our young girls. We've given you our women. We've given you our men. We've given you the big black buck. And you still don't see us as worthy. You still don't think we matter, massa. And that's become the energy that defines almost all of what we're doing right now. I don't care whether we dress it up with tough sounding names or red, black, and green colors or a bow tie or a dashiki or Oxford button down. It don't matter. A three-piece suit or butt naked. It does not matter. We are still clamoring for that white gaze. We're addicted to having massa recognize, hey, I laid down my neck for you so that you can place your foot upon it, in the writing of Robinson Crusoe. We do Groundings on Friday. There's a character in that story called Friday. Go read the story. Because Crusoe named him Friday, because Friday kneeled his neck down before Crusoe to step upon. See, we don't know their story. So we don't know the stories that are being acted and enacted right in front of us. We don't understand the strategic dramaturgy at play and the narratives that we have to suspend disbelief about in order to be transported into. We don't understand the game at hand. We have people who are speaking and don't know what the hell they're talking about. And that's cool. Just stay on your side of the lane. Don't come over this side with Pied Piper confusion that's designed to lead people back to the plantation. We are not going back to the plantation. Muggs talking about a revolution. Muggs talking about black power on display. Muggs talking about an uprising, and yet the same people talking, the same conversation that they were having, doing the same stuff we was doing before the daggone revolution and uprising. So how is it a revolution or an uprising if you're going back to the plantation and doing the same thing and living the same way? Stop playing. This ain't no joke. A quick primer on upcoming deflections and distractions. Number one, the face of white racism and supremacy will become the redneck, the Archie Bunker, dead presidents, monuments, and statues, and the traditional Southern Klansmen, quote unquote, meaning that all of the people who are really empowered at the top of that pyramid on the back of your dollar bill that you worship, that disconnected pyramid where the eye is, that 1% who have no interest in what happens to the rest of the pyramid, particularly the black people at the bottom, all of them disappear, and you begin to direct your ire and your attention to the Archie Bunker redneck liberals, i.e. the noose at the Talladega racetrack or whatever the case may be. So you start chasing down Christopher Columbus statues and Frank Rizzo statues and Archie Bunkers up in Fishtown. They become the face of white supremacy for us, and we begin to direct our fight towards them, and the people who are ripping and robbing us blind disappear and become our friends, like a Joe Biden.
So the white liberals, we begin to say, are on our side, even though they're picking our pockets just as deadly, if not more so, than the Archie Bunker types. So watch it. You're going to start to see a narration everywhere you turn with these low-level victories of white supremacy. We're going to remove a flag here and take down a statue there, and that becomes a definition of our struggle, while the very people who are literally right now still ripping off the mines all across Africa, still controlling the supply chain from A to Z for every product that we purchase, who are making sure that our children are miseducated, who are making sure that the police who are brutalizing us are following a particular set of orders, who are planting and colonizing across the globe as we speak, who are digging up our neighborhoods right now. All of them disappear. While the liberals, the white structures, and the white institutions and the proliferation of racism go untouched. That's the game plan. Watch it. It's happening right in front of your face right now. Number two. And this is important. The face of the black victim, the black sacrifices, which was a big black buck, a big black man, will venture away from the big black straight male buck and will become other ethnics, will become the black bourgeois, talking heads, the LGBTQAI, the immigrants, and maybe even white women. All of them are going to displace the black man or the black person as the source, the face of quote unquote victimhood and sacrifice. Just like with affirmative action, when you look up and you see who benefited from affirmative action, the very people on whose backs, this is the important point, y'all, the people who offer up the blood, the breath, the sweat, and the tears, they very rarely reap the rewards during the Reconstruction. Other people get to write the narrative for them. This is what I'm fighting against. I refuse to let other people who put up no blood, no breath, no sweat, no tears, rewrite the narratives such that they pulling down all the grant money, that they pulling down all the resources, they pulling down all the consulting money, they pulling down all of the stuff that's supposed to go to reconstruct black lives and neighborhoods. All of a sudden, there's this class of people who appear. They wasn't there in the trenches when you was rumbling. They wasn't there over the last decade when people been asking for black power, black Nash fighting for. You didn't see nobody. Matter of fact, they were on the other side saying that you were crazy for doing that. You were crazy for saying the street sign needs to come down. You were crazy for celebrating Kwanzaa. You were crazy for wearing dashikis or wearing your hair natural. Remember that? Because that was just last week. But now all of a sudden, there's an energy around it that's been created and directed. And now all of a sudden, this vulture class of people want to come in and capitalize on blood, breath, sweat, and tears that they ain't offer. Nah. The intersection will become super crowded, and the black bodies that were sacrificed will reap the least from their sacrifice. That's the game that's being played right now. Nah. We ain't going out like that. Additionally, the black male victim and sacrifice, and pay attention now, will become demonized and vilified, fashioned back again as the criminal, the rapist, the murderer, the drug addict, the drug dealer, lazy, tar baby monster, the threat this society needs to cast its hatred upon. So all of that sympathy, that Dionysian, that's Orlando Patterson calls it the Dionysian nature of black manhood and white supremacy. One minute you love him and hate him. He's your champion. He's the supreme victim. And then the next minute, he is your greatest enemy, your greatest threat. And what you're going to see now is the pulling away in the narrated images of black manhood from that quote-unquote George Floyd, Trayvon Martin, Tamir Rice sacrifice, noble sacrifice, by the way. And now the villainization that you'll see. Back to the nigga status that this society needs from black manhood. This society can't process powerful black manhood. They only understand the black man as Friday. Or Fiddler, or Toby. Understand that. This society can only process black manhood as Friday from Robinson Crusoe, as Fiddler, or as Toby. Every other manifestation of manhood, black manhood for them, is seen as a threat. I refuse to be Friday, Fiddler, or Toby. I don't have a problem if you choose to be Friday, Fiddler, or Toby. I really don't. My problem is when Friday, Fiddler, and Toby want to come over and act like they red, black, and green, black national. No, we're not going to have that. You have now stepped out of your lane. Stay in your Friday, Fiddler, Toby lane. This is my public service announcement. 215-634-8065. Toll free 866-361-0900. Be prepared and stay vigilant. For this is the trope playbook that will allow others to reap the rewards of our sacrifice. And look up in a few years and we'll again wonder why we're still stuck in the same superstition. This ain't the way. This idea of playing palatable so that white people can sympathize or demonize or legitimize or validate. That's not a man's walk. It's not a people who are walking in purpose. It's not our walk. We refuse to play Friday, Fiddler, or Toby for anybody's white imagination, Asian imagination, Latino imagination. I don't care whose imagination it is. Even the Negro imagination. Y'all can have that. Do it. If that's what sustains you, if that's what gets you your money in your pocket, if that's how you want to walk your way, no problem. But you don't get to come on the other side that you've castigated and vilified and made fun of and robbed and made sure that people who are too black don't get work. All of that stuff that goes into this, you don't get to act like that didn't happen and now all of a sudden want to be the voice of black power. You don't get to do that. At least not on my watch. Talk to you after these messages.
The pandemic has paused our lives even as conditions change. But when it comes to personal health, our bodies don't have a pause button. This is Dr. Heidi Seropoulos, Medical Director with Independence Blue Cross, reminding you to continue appointments for routine care and vaccinations. Medical offices are taking precautions to create a safe environment for your care, or use telemedicine when available. Refill prescriptions. You may be eligible for a 90-day supply, and many pharmacies now offer free home delivery. If you need emergency care, hospitals are dedicating separate areas for non-COVID emergencies. For heart attacks and strokes, every minute matters. If you visit a hospital or physician's office, wear a face mask, wash your hands, practice physical distancing, and avoid touching your face. For more, visit ibx.com/COVID-19. Don't let this virus keep you from getting the care you need. Together, we will beat COVID-19.
Be heard.
Be heard.
Want another way to join the conversation?
Follow us on social media
using the hashtag #OnWord.
Be heard.
Stay connected to Word Radio.
Independent black media.
Tune in Saturdays from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. to hear Empire Capital and Consulting founder Mark Palmer's show titled Black Money, Black Power. This show centers around black money and how black power is derived from money. Tune in every Saturday from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. Black Money, Black Power, hosted by Mark Palmer.
Do you need health insurance for your children? The Children's Health Insurance Program, also known as CHIP, provides quality, affordable health insurance for Pennsylvania kids. CHIP ensures that kids can go to the doctor, receive health screenings and vaccines, and get what they need to live a healthy childhood. Families can be covered by CHIP no matter how much money they make. If you've experienced a recent change in employment or income, CHIP may be a good option for your family. Visit chipcoverspakids.com to apply or learn more.
Paid for with Pennsylvania taxpayer dollars.
Groundings
with Brother Shomari
right now on Word Radio
and wordradio.com.
Welcome back to Groundings with Brother Shomari. Couple more words before I go to the phone lines. I just want to say this. It's too many people working hard not to be seen as the angry black man or the angry black woman. I talk to these people every day. They feel like they want to advise me on how to
calm down or tame my voice or whatever the case may be. Everywhere I go, everybody got some advice for me. Because they spend all this time not wanting to be seen as the angry black man or the angry black woman. But now that anger is fashionable, everybody want to run to the platform and be the voice of angry blackness. Come on, y'all. Nah, we not playing this hustle game. Every time white supremacy has had to reconstruct itself because of the black push for black power, there's this cadre of the bourgeois. One of the greatest bourgeois who analyzed the cadre of the bourgeois for us is E. Franklin Frazier. Go back and study the black bourgeoisie. Because he's a member of the bourgeois class who's kind of mad about the way that the bourgeois class is undercutting black power and black social movement. It's a tried and true strategy. We can't keep falling for it. You got to earn the right to have voice. And again, if you're going to voice on the team that you chose. Don't try to now switch teams without earning. We didn't trade for you. There was no free agency where we said, oh, come on our side. You just now jumping on a team that you've been working against all of this time. I'm saying, hey, there might be room for you on the team, but at least come through the proper channels. You don't get to come run right to the front of the team and act like you're speaking on behalf of the team, sucking down all of the resources, and attention is a resource. Money is a resource, but also Kazi's work is a resource. Our people's aspirations are a resource. We all need that in order to build a black nation, to build black power. And all of that now is causing confusion amongst the people who are trying to make sense of what is in front of them. And I'm saying that if we make the wrong choices, we're walking off of the road. The crossroads are constipated. They're backed up. They got to be cleared out. And it's a call for people who know that way to step into that way and step into that moment. That's what I'm offering. That's what I've been led to. And, you know, weigh in as you choose. Hit me up at 215-634-8065, toll free. 866-361-0900. Let's go to line one. Greetings.
Hello?
Greetings.
Good afternoon, Brother Shomari.
Good afternoon, Iyaka. How are you?
I'm wonderful. After I heard you, I just want to say, Motupwe, that means thank you in Yoruba, for the message that you are transmitting to the people, as it was transmitted to me by my father, Shango. He is pissed because we act like some cowards. And do not, don't tone yourself down. You are doing exactly what you're supposed to be doing. So ignore those other people. And the message that I have for my brothers and sisters, the EIs, the Nanas, the Babas, the Tatas, the Hugas, the Mambos, our black bodies are going to continue to be sacrificed until we do what we're supposed to be doing, like our brothers and sisters did in Benin the other week. And that's all I got to say.
I know what you're talking about. I appreciate that, and I hear you.
Keep on doing what you're doing, because it needs to be done.
Thank you, Mama. Ashe. Line two, Joseph, greetings.
Are you ready for the revolution, Shomari?
Ready in, not even waiting, because it's on.
Yeah, I know. You know, I'll tell you what the problem and how I always got solution. But you mentioned no Toby, but what about Chicken George? You got to have a Chicken George to entertain myself.
I'm going to get to them, too. That's the problem right now. No, Toby and Chicken George are at the front. How do you take a people who make their wealth and their money and their fame by being palatable to white folks and then let them be the lead of your struggle? That is the problem we have right now. We have people who have been handmade by massa to be palatable and entertaining to massa, and now they are the voices of our struggle, and that is why we're going nowhere.
But that lady got no shame. You know, it was a black man that sold Marcus Garvey out. It was a black man that killed Malcolm X, but you know who was behind that?
Yep.
The same white supremacy. You know, you talk about Archie Bunker. By the way, Archie Bunker went to my high school in Queens. But he graduated from Flushing High School, the next school in my zone. You know what the problem is how you going to accommodate everybody? I read all kind of revolution book. I read like 6 books on Che Guevara. Mao Zedong in China. You got to have alliances. But the problem is the white supremacy is watching over you and picking and choosing who they want to lead. The lesbian, the woman, I got nothing against these big group of people. But we in critical time. We need the black heterosexual man. The best way to fight this revolution, you got to teach the young black man to educate themselves, to go to the library. I'll show you. It was two libraries in my neighborhood, Langston Hughes Library and Flushing Library. Langston Hughes, the kids will come. They'll learn, you know, mostly as a school or a group. When you go to Flushing Library, you got 50,000 Koreans in that in Flushing. You can look it up, Google it. Chinese. And you see the Chinese man, 80 years old, reading the newspaper. You see the two-year-old Chinese kid reading the book, but he can't read. He got the book upside down. You got to put it in the young black man to educate himself. That's the only way. And the other fact is we need to have what they call respect. The people who's running this world right now with this globalization, this new world order, they teach us not to respect each other. In the 60s, we respected each other. The March of Washington, D.C. You heard of Bayard Rustin, right?
I heard of who he is, and I'm saying the thing with respect, Brother Joe, and yeah. I agree with you, is also, though, dignity. You can't respect the people who are taking a knee. I mean, you come into the world with no dignity. So we have people who are leading us back to the plantation, who are saying we need to take a knee, who are saying we need to offer up our neck, who are saying we need to meet people where they are and wallow with the pigs and everything goes. And, you know, we're just so glad that people like us and accept us and listen to us. That's not dignity. And you can't respect a people unless they have their own dignity.
That's why you got to bring back shame. You got to bring back trust. Without these stuff, you're not going nowhere. I've been there, done that. I went to the Shrine of the Black Medallion with a biweekly thing in Houston. I see Minister Farrakhan spoke twice. I've been there, done that. And I refuse to get with any group. Whatever.
30 more seconds. Say,
huh?
I was saying 30 whatever more seconds.
Whatever a black person say, let's come together. I run like hell for them. It's like shooting fish in a barrel. They want to come together, but they want you to go to their church. And I'm an atheist, and I'm a communist, like a Bayard Rustin, like a Langston Hughes, like a W.E. Du Bois, like a Paul Robeson. Why do I want to go to your church so you can force your religion on me? It's about respect. In the 60s, we respected each other's religion. We respected each other's gender, each other's sex. But the people is the people that's running the show, one way or the other.
And I thank you for that. And I'm fighting for the respect of people who put in work, who've always ended up, it seems, in the narrative on the short end of the stick. And then people come later and they rewrite these people and they make them civil rights heroes. Like, I look at what Spike Lee did to Malcolm. I look at how people re-narrate Marcus Garvey. I look at how people re-narrate Harriet Tubman. And the list goes on. And it's like people, you know what? Perfect example, the Black Panther Party. There are people who I know, I talked to them when I was in school in Atlanta, and I talked to them even recently when we were doing Why Children Hate Us interviews. People who really hated, vilified Stokely Carmichael, SNCC, the Black Panthers and the Black Power Movement, because they felt like that movement disturbed the peace, the civil peace that was developed through Martin Luther King and the Civil Rights Movement to get white people to sympathize with the black cause, and all of the effort that went into that nonviolent protest, all of the drama that went into that. You know how much you got to swallow in order to have people beat and kick and sick dogs on you and pour milk over your head and throw rocks at you, and for you not to go back to your natural man or natural woman self and defend yourself? But that was part of the stage. That was part of the drama. They wanted sympathy from the world. So they had to act in a certain way to garner sympathy. And then they felt like after all of that happened, the Black Power Movement, the riots, the uprising, right? All of that came and that blew the doors off of the whole civility of the Civil Rights Movement. And there are people who were so invested in the Civil Rights Movement that they are to this day mad at Black Power, Black Nationalism, Black Panthers, anything that looked like aggression on behalf of black people. And there's a coordinated cadre of people who said, no, we got to keep the lid on that so that we can pull down resources from white people in the name of civility. racial uplift. So I'm saying, cool, that's your strategy. Use it for your own personal aggrandizement and advancement. But you don't get to now come over on the side that you vilified and act like you speak for that side. That's hypocritical. It's disingenuous. And it will be defended against. It just has to be, because we keep losing traction in this moment. We keep fighting and pushing forward and we make an advancement. And then we cede the crossroads to people whose job it is to lead us through the fiddle back to the plantation. And we'll talk a little bit about the ideology, the concept of what plantation really means, because it's not just back to sharecropping or back to slavery and farming agriculturally. That's why even in the industrial economy, it's called the manufacturing plant. A plantation is simply a colony. It's to fix or claim a place or a position. And right now, there's a fight over position. Black nationalism, black power, diasporic unity, Pan-Africanism cannot lose this position again. 215-634-8065, toll free 866-361-0900. Talk to you after these messages.
Check out the source lineup on Word Radio. Mondays, get ready for the rapping professor, Dr. Aaron Smith. On Tuesdays, it's Andrea Lawful Sanders.
Then on Wednesdays,
it's the Black Women's Leadership Council. On Thursdays, it's a second helping of Andrea Lawful Sanders. And on Fridays, it's Tiffany Bacon.
Don't miss the source.
Monday through Thursday, 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. and Fridays, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Exclusively on Word Radio, 96.1 FM. And 900 AM WURD.
Streaming live on wordradio.com and on the Word Radio app.
I'm Joe Biden, candidate for president, and I approve this message. I'm asking for your support to join our team. We need a leader to unite this country. We need a leader who will push an agenda to move everyone forward, to share in our country's great economic prosperity. Someone who will lead, but also who will listen. Someone we can be proud of. This election isn't about me. It's about you, your family, your community, and our country.
Paid for by Biden for President.
Tune in this Saturday from 5 to 6 p.m. for the Islam Today Show, with a perspective on moral guidance and Islamic principles and values.
Hey, it's me, your cell phone. We need to talk about something serious. I know you love me. I know you like using me wherever you are, but I feel like this isn't working out when you're driving. I know you may think that it's possible to focus both on me and the road, but I just don't feel the same way. I think we should spend time away from each other when you're driving. It's for the best.
Visit StopTextStopWrecks.org, a message brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Project Yellow Light, and the Ad Council.
Home of the Happy Hour.
The Happy Hour.
With Sincerely Sarita. This is Word Radio, 96.1 FM and 900 AM WURD Philadelphia.
Streaming live. WordRadio.com and on the Word Radio app.
Groundings
with Brother Shomari.
Right now on Word Radio
and WordRadio.com.
All right, I'm going to jump right back because I got a lot of callers on the line. I'm going to get to them before I continue my... Actually, this is not a rant. This is actually a very, very pertinent thing that we got to get right here. And I want to get to the core of what my point is we're at a crossroads. We've been at a crossroads before. The world around us is reconstructing. They're trying to do it without our authorization or authority about who we're going to be in the world that they're reconstructing for us. And this happened before. Happened after the Civil War. This period called Reconstruction. It happened with the New Deal. It happened with the Civil Rights Movement. We just don't want to really understand that. That's a whole other conversation. And it's happening again right now, where people are trying to author a world and they're getting to determine how and if we participate. And I'm saying we have to have the audacity to author ourselves in the world. One of the problems is we don't really know who we are. We need to start with step one, and that is definition. But we'll get to that. We'll get to the process. But right now, the crossroads have to be clear. There's too much confusion, chaos, and constipation in the crossroads. It has to be cleared. I talked about the idea of the Arukere, which is, you know, people say in the Yoruba tradition, it's a horse. They use it to shoo flies away. Nah, it's deeper than that. You have to clear the air. You have to clear the space. You have to clear your senses in order to bring the power of the word, the power of creation, the power of generativity in order to speak ashe into what you're going to bring forward. You can't build on top of bull. Man, it's so hard not to curse right now. You can't build on top of bull. So you got to clean the bull. You got to get that constipation. You got to get that confusion, that congestion out of the way. It has to go. It has to be cleared. You know, you see people burning sage. All of that is the idea of saying, okay, this air right now has to be purified. So that when we bring Sodayi, or clear word, when we bring Ashe, when we bring Amen, when we bring Ayibobo, when we bring Abibi Fahodie, when we bring it into the space, it can't be built upon bull. So you got to clear the bull. You can't let everybody fake the funk, because you're going to end up back on a plantation. You're going to end up back in servitude. You're going to end up back as a servant of Oyinbo or serving Massa again. And fake victories. Amakal Cabral said, nah, we can't claim easy victories. We can't tell lies. These little symbols and these icons that people are chasing, I don't care that they're moving Aunt Jemima off the pancake waffle. Like, yo, no, that ain't what this rumble's about. Ain't what it's been about. You win the rumble, that stuff falls by design. So you can't let them offer you back mimetic reform that means nothing for your well-being or welfare, and it does not give a foundation for your children's future. You can't let them offer that up as reparation or reward or retribution. Nah, you can't take that. That's like taking trinkets. That's like taking pennies. You can't let them say, uh-oh, they got me now. Let me change Uncle Ben and Aunt Jemima. Let me move the Frank Rizzo statue. Let me change something away from Columbus. That ain't what you fought for. Our ancestral struggle, our struggle, is way bigger than that. Don't sell you. Get up off your knees. Don't sell your soul like that. Don't let people run back to the front of our struggle whose pure job has been to lead us back to Massa's chains. Why would you give them space in our consciousness right now? Get off your knees and protect your neck. Don't offer it up. I refuse to be Friday, Fiddler, or Toby. As a matter of fact, it's time for us to smack down Friday, Fiddler, and Toby. It's time for it. They've gotten, what we've done is we've resurrected or erected Scar to lead the pride. And then we wonder why the pride dies or is hungry. Scar can't lead you nowhere unless he makes a collusion with the hyenas. Scar's power came from his collusion, his allyship, his allegiance with the hyenas. And the hyenas work against the interests of the lion. We've let too many Scars elevate in their platform, and we forget that they're in collusion with the hyenas, and that collusion requires that they work against our interests, our power. They work against the power of the pride, and yet we keep elevating them in their platform. Confusion at the crossroads. We got to rid the constipation. We got to rid the chaos. We got to rid the congestion. Too many intersections in our intersectionality. And we got white liberalism as the traffic cop. And we wonder why there are so many accidents. Their job is to create confusion at our crossroads. Let's clear them out. Let's go to, I think, line 3. Mike, greetings.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to agree because I'm not part of an echo chamber. And I wanted to ask you 2 questions. Number one, there's a reason why very few young people call this station. And I think it's because they're past this. My father fought in a war against the Japanese, and he said he would always hold a grudge against the Japanese, but when he was gone, it would be passed. I see black kids and white kids dating everywhere on college campuses, having a great time. They've forgotten these past.
Yo, Mike, who dispatched you to call? Because I ain't never heard of Mike, your voice. Like, I'm wondering, I want you to answer this question. What dispatched you to call? Who dispatched you to call? Because this topic has nothing to do with you, clearly, by what you're saying, but you felt compelled to weigh in. I've never heard of you before in my life. So let me know.
Yeah, I usually talk to Solomon Jones in the morning, but I don't get to listen too much in the day. But I'm listening, and I got to be honest with you. I think that like I'm real big on DNA and everything. I think that as we all mix and match, and I see African in me, you see European in you. I think in all due respect, just like me, I'm getting older. Maybe you are. I think we're dinosaurs. I think we're dragging people back where they've already passed. And I guess the only question I can ask you is, listening to your show, is do you feel you yourself are a racist?
Do I feel I myself am a racist?
Yes.
No, I feel I myself am very clear that my only purpose is to resurrect the black power necessary to eradicate the fact that you think you have the audacity to tell me what I should think about. That's my purpose.
That's fine. It's a free country.
I know. Mike, it's not a free country. Stop with that bull. It ain't a free country. And that's why we going rumble, because it's not a free country. You need me to believe that. You need people to believe that narrative, but it's not. I live every day in a country that's very clear to me is not free. And therefore, as a man, my duty, whether you want to call it a dinosaur or not, I don't abdicate my duty. My duty is that my children won't grow up with the same shackles and limited freedoms that generations past have. That's my duty. That's what I honor. Whatever name you want to put on it, whatever kind of ice cream dressing about black people dating, but I don't give a two flying hoots about that, Mike. For real, for real. What I care about is this joint ain't free. And parody, I could care less about, to be honest with you. I don't want to be equal to you. I have no desire. You don't matter in my schema except for the fact that you and your people and your culture have made it a point that the only way they can accept black manhood is Friday, Fiddler, or Toby. That's what matters to me. Anybody who wants to buy into that narrative is adversarial to the future well-being of me, my children, and my culture. That is what my dinosaur self strives to eradicate. Thank you for your call. Let's go to Bill, line 4.
Yeah, hey, Brother Shomari.
Hey.
Okay, I always love listening to your show. Hardly ever call. But I think the people will call, and some people will listen, and I have a virus that I call shallow thinking. I think there are many among us who will say that, okay, since young black people may be dating each other, and we're getting statues pulled down, and we're getting new images on the pancake box, that shows that we've made great strides. But I think that we need to look at something deeper than that. And I know you agree, so I'm not preaching to you. But I think we have to decide exactly what it is that we want. There are many of us who will be satisfied with parity. There are others who see a larger picture and see a dying capitalism, and who see that, as Dr. King said, integrating into a burning building is not a good thing. But at the same time, I think we have to look at the reality that we are outnumbered in this situation right now, numerically in terms of people, and definitely outnumbered in terms of resources. But we're 46 million out in a country of 325 or 30 million.
Bill, let me ask you a question.
How do we reckon?
I need clarity on this question, because I hear a lot of people say it, particularly men, black men. Everywhere the European colonized, they were greatly outnumbered when they colonized it. So take that off. Tell me what you're really saying, because that everywhere across this globe, which most of the globe right now, I don't care whether you go to the eastern side that they call Asia or the western side or everywhere the colonization, i.e. plantations, were established, the odds were against the people who were colonizing. So I don't know what people really mean when they say, well, we're greatly outnumbered here in America. What are you actually saying that's supposed to mean for us? Do we concede that we don't have a right to our own sovereignty because we're outnumbered?
No, we should concede that we need strategy.
Okay.
No, because listen, if we are willing to go on an all-out rampage of murdering and killing,
but somehow again, because somebody did this last week in the week. Why do y'all do that? Like nobody even said that. Like that's a fear button, bro, that black men seem to have. But it's like I will take a knee, I will offer up my neck. We need strategy. We need to wait. We need the incremental. All of that stuff. All of those words we're using. Parody. All that comes from the mindset that says, you know what? We're outnumbered, so that means we need to compromise our sovereignty and make sure that we're palatable to massa, because if massa sees us as a threat, something bad might happen to us. And that psychology, that philosophy, that spirit has embedded itself in our people for so long that we actually don't think we're worth freedom at this point. It's 2020, man. If we're not going to fight for it now, we're not going to get it, period. So when do we stop making concessions to who we are? When do we stop conceding our dignity and say, you know what, my children are worth experiencing a world where they're not seen as the bottom? When do the men stand up and say it's our job to deliver that to our people no matter where we are?
Tell me how you propose in your thinking to make that happen without harnessing the righteous indignation of our young people right now. How do we have to educate our people to become as enlightened as you are, sir?
Then you do that, but I'm not clear on why your premise of what does being outnumbered, why do we always refer our push for sovereignty to whiteness? Why are they always the fulcrum that we measure what we can do by? I am saying that is the epitome of our slave mentality. We funnel everything we think about ourselves, our reality, our expectations, our aspirations, we funnel it through this filter we call white supremacy, and then we concede who we're supposed to be as a result. I don't give a daggone flying hoot about that. I don't want to be equal to them. I don't want to be in parity with them. I want to make sure that we can deliver sovereignty to our children. I don't care if we're outnumbered, overnumbered, disproportionate. I don't care if we're the majority or the minority. That has to become the declaration of our Africanness and of our blackness. Anything less, we sell out the whole ancestry that we say we represent.
Sir, I hear you, but I'm saying just saying those words do not make it so. Tell me the plan. Tell me the strategy, sir.
Bruh, listen. Number one, all of my work is about that strategy. So when people call up and you say to me, you don't know what to do or you don't have a plan, number one, I have no respect coming from grown men when grown men say, I don't know what to do, I don't have a plan. Brothers and sisters, every day of my life, we out in the streets doing particular work towards our sovereignty. I don't need to come on this air and talk about what that is, because if it's serious enough to you, I'm the easiest person to reach. I'll be at the Peace Park on certain days. I'll be doing safety patrols on other days. I teach people on other days. The list goes on and on and on. When you are ready, you will find the work, because the work is plentiful. There's people all around this city who are putting in work on behalf of black power, of black sovereignty, of black nation building, and have been doing so for decades. That's my point with y'all. Y'all mubs only see what fits your cowardly nature. It's here for you if you want it. And guess what? You might not die. You could actually work for black power, black nationhood, black sovereignty, and still live. But guess what? You might die. Who cares? There is work to be done. There's a higher calling for us to strive for. When you really want that walk, it will find you, or you will find it. But stop telling me what we can't do because the white man greatly outnumbers us and who's going to do a rampage. Ain't nobody that simple. I bring too much to the game for y'all to reduce this conversation to that level of simplicity. But you know what that is? That's straight up punk talking. It's fear. And everything we say and do right now is funneled through our fear of what we think our potential is as defined by white people. That's the one thing I'm trying to disrupt. If there's one intentionality for me, I might not ever live to see it, is that when my children and the beautiful ones not yet born, when they rise, they're not doing so from a spirit of fear, because our generations are inculcating our people with a punkified spirit of fear, and it has to be undone. Let's go to Joe, line one, greetings.
Hey, Brother Shomari. Hello to Brother Shomari, to your wonderful producer, Sister Brianna. How y'all doing?
We're good, sir.
Praises be to Allah. You know, Brother Shomari, let me flip you before I talk about any of your subject matter. One of our favorite callers and dedicated caller supporters of WRD who called your show a lot, Brother Mo from North Philadelphia.
All right, let's go to line two. Hopefully Joe will call back. I think I know the announcement he was going to make, but I was waiting for official corroboration. But if Joe can call back, I'd appreciate that. Let's go to Rick in Germany.
Good day, Brother Shomari.
Always a good day, Brother Rick. How are you?
I'm sick and dying here in Germany.
Oh, man. Sorry to hear that.
I want to say to you, I come from a military and medical family. The Flowers of Waverly, Virginia. By way of New York and Richmond. My question to you today is, you've expressed yourself on race relations and the fear on our side, but I want to know what you are teaching about COVID-19 and the wearing of the mask.
I don't indicate that I'm teaching. COVID-19 is here, it exists. I have my own personal viewpoints about what it is and how it's a particular attack on certain segments of our population, particularly our elders in phase one. I believe that I don't necessarily wear a I have a mask, and I have my mask because I don't want to have two primary reasons. I don't feel like dealing with police who have wanton reason to pull me over and deal with me regarding a mask. And number two is just stores I can't go into unless I have a mask. But you know, there's a bigger conversation I want to have on COVID-19 that I'm going to do on Sunday and on Sunday's show, because I believe that we have not yet really done a good forensic analysis of 2020 period COVID-19 as it relates to the what we call riots and looting and protests that we're experiencing now. There's a through line that's related. That for me has to do with the reconstruction of the globe and the new emerging industrial revolution and global economy and how people fit into that or not. That is really the metamythic and macro level thing that we have to understand if we're going to understand what's happening on the ground. And I don't think black people have a particular narrative or story that's clear about what's actually happening at a global level that these local phenomena we call COVID or the protests or whatever fits into. So I don't know if that answers your question. It probably doesn't. You know, COVID-19 is here. It's something that we got to deal with, and you got to figure out strategically how you navigate it. My point to you is what it means depends on your purpose and your intentionality. So most people have cowered in place and sheltered in place, which to me is the worst strategy we as black people could have deployed, particularly for our elders, because I said to people early on, those nursing homes and hospitals that we are pushing our people into will become the very killing fields for our seniors. And that is what happened, because we didn't understand the attack at the level that the attack was, and that they were trying to eradicate certain roles, certain responsibilities like pension and social security for a certain class of our people, our senior citizens, and our unhealthy. So we actually offered them up unwittingly because we followed the advice of a government, and we don't understand racism. We think that Donald Trump is a racist is the issue. The issue is that we live in a white settler, colonial, slave, racist society. And that all of the systems of this society conspire to assure that reality. That is the definition of America. It is the American dream. And as long as we keep buying into that, we will always play the role of the sacrifice. And until we wake up and decide that we want to be better, walk in our sovereignty and our dignity, every strategy that this society uses will work according to its purpose. And its purpose is to maintain us at the bottom of that pyramid. If they want us to participate, if they choose that they don't want us to participate, then its purpose becomes to extinguish us. And we play along because we've brought into their dream, and their dream is a nightmare for us. Can't make it any clearer than that. Thank you for your call. Let's go to Stanley, line three. Greetings.
Brother Shomari, how you doing today, man?
I'm doing all right. Yourself, sir?
Yeah, thank you, Creator. We're doing good. Brother Shomari, I appreciate you, man. And I respect your consistency in giving information that is not talked about on a regular basis. And I think what I'm hearing from some of the people, you're talking about sovereignty over our own existence on this continent we call North America. And that's something that I think we can achieve if we just get out of that paradigm of giving white people all of this credit and even ownership of this land. They might have governance over this land, but they don't own the land if we really look at it, because the Indians did not have a concept of ownership of land, and that's why they was able to do what they did to the Indians with the booze and all these trinkets, because they wasn't aware that you was talking about ownership of land when they put that X on that paper. Mm.
Let me just offer real quick into your statement, sir, then I'll let you finish. And that's why I'm going so hard on the symbols right now, because they have us between the offering of your neck in submission or kneeling. Those are the two most symbolic symbols of submission to someone else's agenda. That's the act of colonization, is to make you kneel, to make your king kneel before their king, to make your king or your head or your sovereign offer his neck in submission to another sovereign. And that's why you see those images being played against each other in the media right now. We're at a moment about our sovereignty, and these people have shown you, this culture has shown you what they do when they feel that they have you under their foot. They go for the kill. And so until we get serious about the moment that we're in, we're going to find ourselves always on the losing end of the sacrifice equation.
Yeah. What I looked at, Brother Shomari, was this. The Moors conquered Spain for 700 years, correct?
Yes, sir. Now, give or take.
Now, 700 years. But the Spanish never gave up hope of reconquering the land that they had, that they originally had occupied. So when we're thinking about what we're thinking about, there is no, if we think as independent thinkers, we have the ability to come up with a strategy that would give us dominance over our own governance. And that's the whole difference that I'm seeing is, in our thought processes, we are surrendering to the governance. And here's another piece, too. I'm not worried about white people being racist. If that's what they want to be, they got a right to be racist. The white folks have a right to say, I don't want to live with you black folks.
Exactly.
I don't want to take that right from them. But we have a right to say we don't want to live with them also.
Exactly.
And for those of us who want to stay with them when we have our own sovereignty, you can stay. Those of us who want to go back to the continent should have a right to go back to the continent. But this thing of us having to intermingle with each other got to be taken off the table in order for us to move forward, brothers.
And I thank you for that, because that's what I'm trying to revisit. In the storytelling of the history, we don't understand that those points you just made used to actually be the dominant position of when we were considering who we wanted to be in our own reconstruction, the idea of going back to the continent or going to Haiti or going to Jamaica, going to the Bahamas, going to Canada, having our own states. Like, there was actual conversation about how we were going to self-author. And I am saying we got to bring that back. I'm not telling you what to think or do. I don't necessarily have a or the solution. I am saying our mindset that says we have the right. Not only do we have the right, we have the duty, the obligation to have the audacity to write who we want to be, choose to be, and how we're going to position ourselves in this evolving new world is what it means to be a man and a woman. So we got to get up off of our knees, and we got to stop offering up our neck in order to write our own way forward. Joe, let's go back to you. You're about to make an announcement.
Yeah, Brother Shomari, I just want to make an announcement to you and Sister Brittany and the WRD family. One of your dedicated callers and supporters of your show and this station, Brother Mo from North Philadelphia, made transition today. And I just wanted to call up and let you and the listener over there know, Brother Shomari.
Well, I appreciate that. Brother Joey was calling and notifying me, and I really wanted to make sure that, because when I first heard it, I wanted to make sure it was true. I'm always, like, emboldened, if you will, by Mo's affirmations and you know, that deep voice that this culture in its own way tries to drown out, right? Yeah. Tries to make that a problem. That's what our people need to hear. That sense of direction, that sense of I got you, that we can do this. We could actually win. And so when I heard that earlier today, I kind of had to, my whole energy kind of hit me hard. So I appreciate you for letting us know that, my brother, and offer all acknowledgement, affirmation in the brother's transition into a more powerful force that can help us win, man. We can win, y'all. It's really that simple. But we got to get up off our knees. we got to get up off our neck. You don't offer that up to any man, to any society, to any system. And we got to stop teaching our children this spirit of fear. We got to stop teaching ourselves. We got to really stop. I mean, because, you know, we can talk about patriarchy all we want, but you ain't going to go no further than your men. And when your men aren't, they become real heavy when they decide not to take up the vanguard. They become brothers you got to drag and brothers you got to carry. And so when your men have abdicated, when your men say we can't win, then the whole structure and energy of your village goes into supporting Scar. And Scar can only rise when he makes allegiance with the hyenas. And so we have a Scar-driven, hyena-driven village right now. We got to clear that out the way. We got to stand up with our spines erect so that we can deliver the future our people deserve. We will talk with you. Tell me something good after these messages.
The Dr. Emeka Show. Saturdays at 1 p.m. right here on WURD 96.1 FM and 900 AM. Streaming live at wordradio.com and on the Word Radio app.
Listen to Laborers Live.
We created the weekend. We created the 40-hour work week. We just want enough to feed our family, be able to send our children to college, and let our next generation do better than we did.
To people that might have forgot how important unionism is in a country like the United States. People now infringing on our 8-hour work day, trying to work people more than 8 hours without overtime, trying to work people without benefits. In the long run, everybody's getting fat paycheck except the worker. So this is really a wake-up call for America.
The struggle is continuous. Tune in to Laborers Live every Friday from 4 to 5 p.m. Sponsored by LESSET, the Laborers Employers Cooperation Education Trust of the Laborers District Council of Philadelphia and vicinity.
Local 332, Sam Staten Jr. Business Manager. Local 57, Esteban Vera Business Manager. Local 135, Dan Woodall Jr. Business Manager. Local 413, James Harper Jr. Business Manager. The Laborers District Council, Ryan Boyer Business Manager, and Tony Staten, Executive Director of LESSET.
Word Radio, 96.1 FM and 900 AM, WURD.
Family Therapy, Vignette Moments with Dr. Lucille Ijoy.
Be kind behind the mask. Let us train our eyes and our hearts to show a loving attitude. If you're using a mask, be kind behind the mask. I see worried eyes, painful hearts, stressed bodies behind the mask. Don't let the mask make you mean. 6 feet back, everybody, and wears your mask. No, 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 let's not do it like that. Let's smile behind the mask. Express kindness behind the mask. Good morning. Can we say that behind the mask? Did somebody stay in a spiritual way, being kind behind the mask? And now to our wonderful men and fathers, grab your partner, maybe your children. Dance. I hope you dance. Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. It's June. We all love you.
Groundings with Brother Shomari.
Right now on Word Radio.
And wordradio.com.
Once again, I know things are tough, but I'm Nathaniel Lee, and this is a segment we call Tell Me Something Good. But first, as always, let me first say thank you to Brother Shomari. He's on fire today. I wanted to call in earlier, but I said let me save some time for the guests. I'll get my time later. So greetings, Brother Shomari.
Greetings, Brother Nate. How are you?
I am well, all things considered, and they could be much better, but I'll get into that later. And Sister Brianna is always holding it down in the studios, our wonderful producer. How are you, Sister Brianna?
I'm good.
Good. Brother Shomari, I was listening to your show, and like I said, I wanted to call in so bad and chime in on the subject because you are on fire today, my brother. Sometimes it's hard trying to come up with positive things to say because I'm not in a kind of positive mode right now. So I'll be honest with my listeners, you know, on being transparent, you know, all things being transparent, I try to be honest with you guys right now. I'm on kill mode.
liberation and freedom is always positive, my brother.
Yeah, but I think this is something in between. This is on a more personal thing. You know, sometimes, you know, we battle on two fronts. We have that double consciousness, and so it's always at war. And so sometimes it's the blue-eyed devils, and then most of the time we find ourselves having, before we even get to that level of battle, we have to break through the barriers and buffers of the brown-eyed minions of the blue-eyed devils. But
we got to call them out. See, and that, you know, they had that Bible verse that talks about fighting not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Principalities are only princes. Principalities are the people who govern dominion. And there's a group of people in our community, we need to be very clear, whose job it is to maintain dominion of the city for the powers that be. They have pledged allegiance to serving those powers. And they have been activated. You can hear it in the narrative. The narrative is changing. You can see it in there. These organizations that should be dead by now, like the National Urban League and the NAACP, they're pulling down money and resources for the very thing that they exist to be the antithesis of. And so mugs just got to call it out what it is, and the ship's going to fall where they may. But these mugs are being activated, man, and our people don't know. These are the principalities. These are the principalities that we fight against. Principalities just govern institutions, man. So this is the rumble. Let's engage it. Let's embrace it. It's fun.
Absolutely. And so those are some of the struggles I'm dealing with on a personal level. And on a collective level, as you know, COVID-19 just tore up many businesses, you know, financially. A lot of black businesses, we don't have the resources that other businesses have. We, you know, institutional racism has always been an impediment to us. We've always found it more difficult to get established, to get financed. And so that's why this segment of Tell Me Something Good, I thought it vital that we bring to our people, because we know all too well the story of not having the finance or being so-called redlined. But this one gentleman, Dr. Kenneth Scott of the Beach Companies, you know, in a time when we need it most, when many businesses are closing their doors and may not open again, businesses that serve our community and who are of our community now have an opportunity, thanks to what he and the Beach Companies are doing, to at least get a little help, to at least get a little assistance. And so I just wanted to bring him on, regardless of how I feel, my personal chaos. I wanted to have Dr. Scott on to talk about what they're doing and the grants that they're distributing to black businesses in the community. So do we have Dr. Scott on?
Hello.
Dr. Scott, can you hear us?
Yep. Hello.
Yes, I'm here. We were talking about, first of all, introduce yourself. We were talking about some of the work that is needed in the communities, especially in light of COVID-19 and how that impacts financially our communities. Tell us about yourself and what you're doing to help some of those struggling businesses.
Okay, well, first of all, Beach, this is our 30th year at Beach, and you know, as an organization that's been working in primarily North Central Philadelphia, we work all over the city now. But through working with black businesses, trying to focus on community and economic development, you know, affordable housing. But, you know, in particular, economic development, you know, we know that's the key, trying to bring that equality and wealth to our communities. And so, yeah, that's what we've been doing. And then, of course, during this pandemic, we had a couple things with the emergency grants, because, you know, we knew how people were struggling. So we started to immediately shift our focus onto helping the food pantries and the shelters and some of the other institutions that really needed, you know, the boots on the ground organizations that really needed funding right away. So we just kind of shifted some priorities and some other projects we just put to the side so that we could focus on being helpful, you know, in our community.
Tell me more about the boots on the ground, because you're talking about something that's dear to my heart. I really believe in internal sovereignty. I believe in self-sufficiency. And so when communities do things within themselves to help themselves, you know, now you're talking my language. So tell me about that grant, which helps black businesses do that in black communities.
Yeah, so one thing, said that Beach is one of the very few, a handful around the country, of actually black foundations. We have our foundation actually is grant-giving foundations. You know, there's all kinds of foundations that are working on, we'll have summer camps and some of these other things that are set up by athletes and things like that. Nice programs, but very few of them are actually giving out grants, cash grants, to actually help other organizations. So this, which is very unusual, because usually because we're restricted by the rules of the federal government, of the IRS, is that this is actually grants for businesses. And very rare does it come out with, like, hey, here's actual grants for businesses. So this was something that was part of the federal government dollars that from the CARE Act that they were given to each of the states. The state then wanted to hand some of this money out to help businesses across the state. But, again, no conversation really about, you know, black businesses. So we were able to, you know, lobby and remind people this doesn't just, like, this money doesn't magically, you know, fall from the sky. I'm not trying to give you any of this money. So, but the first question was, why does this have to be loans? Because they really wanted this to be loans, and, you know, people are already drowning in debt. So we have other loan programs for people who could use and need that, and lines of credit. We do a lot of that with nonprofits and other businesses as they're, like, you know, waiting for funding and so forth, or their seasonal businesses. But this actually was the lobby from that it not be loans, but actually be grants. So that's what this program is about. There's 17 community development financial institutions across the state of Pennsylvania. They know that, you know, we have loan programs. We're right in the community. We know the community and the businesses. So the idea was to turn this funding over to us in a pot that we could go to. So our second challenge was, okay, you know, there's a lot of businesses across the state. You know, of course, we're talking majority businesses. What about black businesses? And, you know, in these communities, and not just Philadelphia, but, you know, in the surrounding counties, you know, we have black people spread out all over the county. I mean, I have some black businesses I was just on the phone with the other day that are in Erie, PA. Can't get much further than that in Pennsylvania, up to Erie.
Can't get much further than that.
Yeah, always, you know, and they're always left out. So, again, we're trying to be helpful to all black businesses. And so we did get a carve out for that. So basically, it was a $200 million pot. We got a $100 million set aside that will go into black. Of course, they were going to say historically disadvantaged, which means black, brown, and Asian businesses and, you know, Pacific Islanders, Native American. But of course, you know, we're focusing on black businesses in our community. And so, yeah, so this will be a program that will be launched next week. They can always go to our website, which is beachinterplex.com. But it's 17 CDFIs, is also the West Philadelphia Financial Partnership, maybe familiar with. United Bank actually has a community development financial institution branch, you know, subsidiary of their organization. So they'll be handling some of this, and North Philadelphia financial institution. So there's, you know, ways to for you to connect and the people to connect. Go to the website, get the information. There's a Q&A question sheet on there, and applications will start to be taken next week. Now, the qualifications, more importantly for this, is really people who are affected by COVID. This is money affected by COVID. Nothing, you know, what else has happened with the uprising and some of the other issues. This has to be directly related that your business was shut down, like the barbershop, hair salons, any business, but that was affected by COVID. And then the basic rules of government, of course, is we must see your tax returns from last year or 2018. If you didn't do 2019, you have 2018, that's fine. Submit that with your ID and that your, you know, your federal and state taxes. This is a, you know, a program being directed out through the state, so it's not really directed with the city. So your federal and state tax, your state license that you're able to operate, even if you're an independent barber, you don't own the shop, but you have your license. People like that can then go ahead and apply, get online, you know, with their tax returns, and just send the information out. There's, you know, some additional steps on there, of course. As usual, we've tried to make it as simple as possible, like one common application. And the other thing about this program, we know that, you know, when they had that PPP program, of course, we know what happened. Everyone rushed through the gate. And, of course, it was inside baseball and everybody who, you know, the big shops got there first and gobbled up all the money. Then they came out with a second round. So with this fund, we decided right away that we can't have that. You know, we want this to be a fair process, as fair as we can make it. So it'll actually be four rounds of funding. So if you have paperwork that you need to get together, okay, don't worry about it in July. You can apply to the next round. Okay, you can apply to the third round, and then there'll be a final fourth round of funding. So, and it's based on a scorecard, so it's not like, hey, me and Nate are cool, me and Brother Shomari are cool, he's getting a grant, but you're not getting a grant. No, this is based on scores of need, of you were out of business, you had no income, or how you were affected, and they'll give you a scoring grade, and that's how they'll issue the grant.
Dr. Scott, you just answered three of my questions, and I didn't even ask them, so thank you for that. And look, one of the problems we had with some other loan / grant opportunities, and I understand this is a grant, not a loan, I just wanted to make sure I clarify that, but there's been problems as far as people having the ability, the application process was so complex that people just said, ah, never mind. They started it. They abandoned it because it was way too far from all they needed help. Will this be that complicated? And if so, will there be help available for people who feel as though they can't handle the application process themselves?
Right. So as I said earlier, we're trying to make it very simple, that there's a very simple, straightforward process. A lot of this is just checking the boxes off and verification. Obviously, you need to show that you have a loss, or you needed some additional revenue because you had to make, you know, upgrades because of COVID, right? So you had to make some changes. So you have to write a statement about that. It has to be included. The rest of it is just showing documentation that, hey, I'm in good standing with the federal and state government. And if you're not in good standing, that you have now made a payment plan with them to get in good standing. So either way, you're in good standing, you're making a payment plan. After that, of course, is, you know, your identification and some of the other you know, check the box type of questions. And there is technical assistance. That's what the CDFIs are here for. So if you have questions, there's going to be a common general number that you can call. You can talk to someone that provides you assistance there. And of course, the CDFIs that you choose to work with, a lot of people already have relationships. That's who you would get in touch with, and they'll help you with the process.
Now, so tell me one more time the dates. You're beginning when, and then tell me again, how long people will have to actually apply? What are the deadlines?
Okay, so the deadline, we're hoping to have it open on June 30th, no later than July 1st. July 1st starts the new budget year. But we're trying to have it go live sometime on June 30th. Now, that could be 12 p.m., not sure about any of that. But for sure, if you check by July 1, you know that the application process should be there. And you have all the way from that date, let's say July 1st, all the way to November.
Wow.
So you have 5 months to apply for this program.
Mm-hmm. And again, these are grants. So those who apply for it, they meet the requirements, they apply for it, they have the necessary hardships, they will not have to pay this back.
No.
Great.
Cash coming back to you. Like I said, we fought hard for this because, you know, we are a foundation, one of our operations, and we do give out grants, so that's why they were happy to work with us because, you know, we understand we're trying to avoid, the city, of course, they're trying to give, grant money out. One of the frustrations I had, though, is many people came to me with that city grant process, and if you had any things, I mean, minor infractions like a trash lien and things like that, that knocked you out from getting a city grant. Now, this is an emergency. This is a worldwide emergency. We're going to hold people because you had a trash lien or some other minor infraction that stops you from getting a grant or one of those other loans. It's like, come on.
So, Mr. Scott, if you could, before we go to commercial break again, if you could quickly give anybody listening the information that they would need to follow up.
Sure. So you can go to our website, which is Beach Interplex, and that's B-E-E-C-H, Interplex, I-N-T, ERPLEX.com, and our number is 215-763-8824.
And could you repeat that just one more time for people who might have been slow to getting their pen or pencil together?
I got you. Okay, and you know, if you want to just Google beach companies, you can just Google beach companies, and it'll come right up to our website. But the direct address is B-E-E-C-H, beach as in the beach tree, Interplex, INTERPLEX.com.
I thank you for joining us on our Tell Me Something Good segment right here on Groundings with Brother Shomari. With my good brother Nathaniel Lee, Tell Me Something Good will come at you every first and third Friday of the month starting in July. So thank you, Brother Nathaniel. Thank you, Brother Ken Scott, for joining us today.
Good, man. Same thing. I was ready to call in earlier, man. Jump in that conversation.
Feel free. I mean, you can hang up and call back and jump right in. I look forward to hearing your perspective.
Several stories, brother. Oh, man.
Coming up on the commercial, when we come back, we'll continue our dialogue about principalities, y'all. That's really what we're talking about. We're talking about principalities at the crossroads, and we got to clear the crossroads if we're going to move clearly into our future, and our future should be our own sovereignty. So we'll talk with you after these messages. Hit us up at 215-634-8065, toll free 866-361-0900. Talk to you then.
Hi, this is Councilwoman Cindy Bass. We've been through a lot together in these last 3 months. Too many Philadelphians have lost their lives to COVID-19, and too many more have lost their livelihoods. As our stores and shops start to reopen, we have to protect our loved ones, friends, and neighbors to prevent any more spikes in this disease. Don't let your guard down, Philly. Practice social distancing when you go out, and always wear your mask. Mask up, Philly.
Seniors, if you're over the age of 60, you're at high risk for the coronavirus. This is Dr. Chris Chen, CEO of Dedicated Senior Medical Centers, with an important message. These are challenging times for all of us, but especially for you. At Dedicated, we're working hard to help our patients stay healthy, happy, and at home. We understand you need us, and that's why we offer doctor phone visits and delivery or pickup medication services. In fact, if you need to see a doctor, we'll even pick you up. Our centers remain open to see you by phone or in person now, when you need medical advice the most. Seniors, if you need a primary care doctor who is available to you now and always will be, we can help. Please call us at 800-451-7008. That's 800-451-7008. Stay safe, stay healthy, and stay at home.
Support independent black media and join the Forward Movement now at 215-425-7875 or visit wordradio.com.
Tune in every Saturday at 6 p.m. to Recovery Talk 101 with your host, Rick Ford, talking about addiction, treatment, and recovery right here on Word Radio.
Word Radio would like to thank everyone who started or renewed their membership during our Forward Early Bird special. You truly are the most critical piece of Word Radio continuing to be independent black media. What? What's up?
I think you're forgetting something.
What? What am I forgetting?
I don't know. Maybe the host showdown winner?
Oh, geez. All right. Sorry. Word family. You also selected the winner of our Early Bird Host Showdown. And the winner is... Wake Up with Word with Solomon Jones and super producer Kwesa Mathis. Stay tuned to Word Radio and wordradio.com to find out more about the upcoming Wake Up with Word swag. And tune in to Wake Up with Word and the entire lineup right here on Word Radio, 96.1 FM and 900 AM WURD. Groundings with Brother Shomari right now on Word Radio and wordradio.com.
Hey, come along with me, let your spirit run free along your black night. Hey, take my hand and see creation's plan along your black night. My ancestry and history is calling me. Come on, let's see. Hey, just how it used to be. Hey, come along with me. Let your spirit run free along the old black night. Hey, come along with me. Let your spirit run free. Let it run free. Hey, 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 hey. Take my hand and see creation's plan along the old black Nile. My ancestry, history is calling me. Come on, let's see how it used to be. Oh, hey, 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 hey. Shee-da-doo-dee, ba da 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 ba da. We'll be right back. how it used to be. Hey, 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 hey. Let your spirit run free. Ooh, B, D, she do 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 do.
My ancestry is calling me, y'all. It's calling me back to my sovereignty. Nothing less. No knees. No necks. Nah, I can't do that. Today's Bible verse will be taken from Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. We got some resurrecting to do, y'all. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And, you know, growing up in church, oftentimes people would take that little saying right there and they flip it and make it seem like, nah, man, you ain't in a fight against people. You know, it's all that stuff up there in the sky that God is supposed to handle. That's, you know, that's not our fight. Nah, principalities are rulers. Just so you're clear. Principalities in this old Hebrew usage, which is the basis for the Bible that y'all read, just meant rulers and authorities. Principalities essentially is the dominion of the princes. A prince's dominion, which is essentially the city or the fiefdom, the place that the princes rule. Again, we ain't talking about king level stuff. We're talking about these mugs who rule over, like city council. They would be principalities, just in case y'all don't get it. See, you actually have a biblical obligation to rumble for righteousness against the principalities that are ruling us right now. Your mayor would be a principality. You know, it doesn't exonerate you from dealing with the real life stuff that's in front of us. It doesn't say, okay, now I just got to pray it away and it'll go away. It essentially calls you to a fight against the structures that restrict your sovereignty, your righteous sovereignty. See, I'm just trying to strip away what we use to be cowards, what we use, the reasons and the rationales that we hide behind that says, nah, we just got to grin and bear it. We just got to cower in place. We just got to do whatever they say. Nah, it don't work like that. You are actually righteously called to resist and push back against unrighteous principalities. So let's man up and woman up and walk in that way. Because what we need to understand is that just like we're called forward to push back against principalities, there are organizations and entities and people who exist to protect those principalities. And they look like us. Their oath is to protect the dominion of the prince, to protect the principalities. And so when you go back and you look at the oath that they take to do that, they're oath takers who have been activated now to keep us in our place on the plantation, which is a principality. The plantation is a principality. It just means a place where you planted your dominion. It could be a manufacturing plantation, manufacturing plant, or it could be an agricultural plantation, or it can be a colony. The American plantation, the Jamaican plantation. Those are the dominions of the princes or the principalities that we must engage and struggle with if we're going to reclaim our righteous sovereignty. When you see people take a knee, when you see people offer their neck, they've said to you, I'm Friday, I'm Fiddler, I'm Toby. I am no threat to your principality. But we have been commissioned to fight against, to wrestle against, and to win against principalities. If we're going to deliver sovereignty to ourselves and to our children and the beautiful ones not yet born, it's time for us to defeat the principalities that bind us. Anything less is cowardice. We'll talk with you after these messages.
Don't just talk about it. Be about it.
Be about the 2020 census.
Our answers impact public funding for our schools, roads, health clinics.
They even shape congressional representation.
Just go to 2020census.gov.
Or complete the census by phone or by mail.
Count everyone you live with. So, let's get real about our future.
Don't just talk about it.
Be about the 2020 census.
It's not too late. Shape your future. Start here at 2020census.gov. Paid for by U.S. Census Bureau.
This is not a fad for us.
We will not resume our regular programming when things die down. We're not black to help our bottom line or because it's politically correct. We're not joining a fight. This has been our fight, our message, our people. Black lives have always mattered here. We are
undeniably,
indefatigably,
unapologetically,
permanently
Black
Talk Media.
WURD.
P&G presents This Black Music Maker's Moment. The aspirations of a focused, determined parent are powerful. In gospel music, it was Dr. Mattie Moss Clark, matriarch of the Clark Sisters. Mattie Moss Clark was a legendary choir director, and her daughters Twinkie, Jackie, Dorinda, and Karen were always under her wing and guidance. That guidance and musical discipline has made the Clark Sisters the best-selling female gospel group in history.
Who said that?
The lady at the store.
That is not a compliment.
It's an ugly, nasty word, and you are going to hear it. But you are not going to let that word hurt you.
There are some people who think you don't deserve the same privileges just because of what you look like. It's not fair.
Remember, you can do anything they can.
You are beautiful, period.
Visit pg.com/takeonrace. A message from Procter & Gamble.
This is Word Radio.
96.1 FM.
And 900 AM WURD Philadelphia.
Black Talk Media.
Groundings.
With Brother Shomari.
Right now on Word Radio.
And wordradio.com.
History is calling me. Come on, let's see how it used to be. Hey, 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 hey. Let your spirit run free. Ooh, be, dee, shee, doo, dee, dee.
And that is Gregory Porter's song, Black Now. Listen to it. Check it out, y'all, because he says let your spirit run free. And what I'm pushing back against right now is the idea. See, there are these archetypes that are created in our community whose purpose is to defeat your spirit, to prevent it from running free. You remember when Kunta wanted to be free and run free, Fiddler's job was to say, no, stay here on the plantation. It's safer here. You might get hurt. Mammy's job is to raise white power and dispirit her black children because she believes, she's scared, she believes in masses authority. So she raises masses children to maintain their power, and at the same time, she don't want the spirit of her children to run free, so she raises them in fear. That's the purpose of the troop. See, we battling tropes. We battling at all levels. We battling flesh and blood, flesh and blood, but we're also battling principalities and powers and spirits. This is total war. This is a total rumble for the sovereignty of our people, because this culture by design does not want our black spirit to run free. So they require people on the black side of the chessboard whose job it is to dispirit our people. They dispirit us through fear. They dispirit us by believing that sovereignty should not be our goal. There are people whose job, there are organizations who've come into the fore whose job it is to protect the principalities. Fela called them servants of Oyinbo, those carriers, those collaborators with the colonizers that Aikwe Armah talks about in The Healers. They are servants of the king. It's an organization that came into the fore. The Boule came its purpose. A lot of our organizations, by the way, in the early 1900s, go back and read the oath that they take. See, I'm not even getting deep with you. I'm just saying go read what they say. Go read the mission of the National Urban League that comes about in 1910. Go read the mission. Also, organizations that are not created by us, but created for us by people who want to control us because they want us to protect their principality. That's how this works, y'all. This ain't complicated. So go read the charter and the mission statement of the NAACP created in 1909, or the Boulé created in 1904. Or the National Urban League in 1910. Go back and really understand what those original Greek letter fraternities created in 1906, 1908, 1911, 1911, 1913, 1914, 1920. All of this coming out around this racial uplift time, this idea that we want an image of a powerful Negro without the power. Because we want to work with you to protect the principalities. As long as you create a space for the bourgeois Negro in the principality, we will subvert the will of the masses. We will suppress the will of the masses. We will tell the masses what to think about power, about the idea of Garvey saying you can create your own nation. We'll suppress that. We'll work with you, massa, to destroy that. See, I want us to understand that this is historically precedented. So that when you see people coming to the fore who are trying to run to the forefront of a conversation about what it means for us to walk in our own power, there's an intentionality that is by design to say, no, I got to take that energy and direct it back to the plantation because I can't have niggas thinking for themselves. I can't have black people defining their own power and sovereignty on their terms. So I got to rush to the airwaves. I got to rush to the video. I got to rush to the television. I got to get in front of the music. I got to redirect the hip hop. I got to redirect everything in my power to maintain the principality. Lest they remember that their fight is against principalities. They might forget what Reverend Chicken Bone taught them and said, no, you pray. No, they might understand that it's actually the most righteous thing you can do is to fight against the principalities that oppresses you. That's what makes you a man or a woman. That's what makes you a people. So I gotta create principality protectors to run into the front of the conversation. And direct us back to the plantation. I don't care whether it's the agricultural plantation or the manufacturing plantation. All of it is beneath our dignity and sovereignty. And it's time for us to resurrect who we're going to be as a people. This red, black, and green means something. Being African means something. And guess what, y'all? Being black means something. It's not a negation of whiteness. Black is an essence of power. We existed in our power before there was a white European who could ever assert that he even understood that the globe was not flat, but round. Whiteness is a negation of blackness by its very definition and conceptualization. We are not tarnishing blackness. I mean, whiteness. We are not a stain on whiteness. Whiteness was created to differentiate itself and its society and its cultural ways from us, which is the essence of civilization. We got to teach that to our children so that their spirits can run free, so that they reclaim their ancestry and their purpose, and most important, their power and sovereignty. There should be no other agenda for us. Anything less is compromise, selling out. Anything less is bowing down, taking a knee, and offering your neck. Let's get our dignity back. It's really that simple, and it shouldn't even be a conversation. Let's go to Brother Wasset. Greetings and good afternoon.
Hey, greetings, my brother. How are you?
I'm doing all right.
Good, good. The first thing I wanted to say is that, you know, that message about Brother Mo really hit hard.
Yeah, it kind of threw me, too.
It really hit hard because, you know, just hearing him, I don't care what you want, you know, what you say, his message was always clear and it was consistent. And for me, it kind of like recharged me to let me know that I wasn't in this fight alone. And that I wasn't thinking. My thinking was not in isolation, you know. Mm-hmm. So I just want to, you know, like I said, just, you know, rest in power for him.
I see.
The other thing that I want to say too, because you touched on so many things, and I think one of the things that I want to say is that I appreciate your clear message, and I have to say that because there are a lot of messages that are being put out there that are not clear and that are confusing our people. So I appreciate the clear message. And one of the things that I know is that whether people are working directly or indirectly with you, that having a clear message helps you to understand the work that needs to be done. Mm. So I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Another thing, we need to understand. You talk about the principalities. The last message from my spiritual mentor is Shaka Musa Brashango. He talked about the fact that this is spiritual warfare, that this is not physical warfare. And it may be physical in a sense.
It's as above, so below. It's the law of complementarity, man. We got to embrace the fact that it's at all of those levels.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But here's the part that I wanted to mention. When people, and I hear this all the time, and when people always say, well, what are you going to do? They got this, they got this, they got armies. And I try to, first of all, and when I'm talking to religious people or you, whether you're a Muslim or whatever, I'm just trying to say, so you're trying to say that this government or white people or whatever, they're stronger than your God, than your Allah, or than your the spiritual deity that you believe in?
We seem to practice that every day.
Right. That's what I'm saying. So something's wrong with that. When you know, and like you said, it's fear-based. But when and that's why we had to learn our history, because I know at a point, Haiti was looked at as a minority and that was an impossible fight, you know, but yet that power, that French power that people thought that could not be beat, it was won. So again, I appreciate the clear message. The last thing that I want to say is that, and I'm so glad that you touched on it, concessions are not liberation.
Mm.
Why do I care about why do I care about you tore down the original statue, but on the books you still got the law, stop and frisk?
Right.
Stop playing games. And see, here's my thing. Our ancestors have already given us the information and the roadmap for our freedom. All we have to do is follow it. And the Black Panther Party, if anybody asks me what I want, I'm going to tell you, in October of 1966, when the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense came out with this 10-point program, that's what I want.
There you go.
I don't care about the statue. I don't care about, now that you gave Aunt Jemima a perm or you took off the I don't care about that. What I want is what they want, because here's my thing. You can't give me concessions when I think about what my ancestors went through, that you killed them,
right,
that you murdered them, that you lynched them, that you burnt them, and that we still have individuals being lynched right now. Why do I care about any of that? How is it that we have not learned yet that what they're trying to do is they want to pacify you?
We learned. We're just scared of the rumble. We're just scared to fight the principalities that we've been designed or designated to fight. And it's we're getting concessions that we haven't even demanded. That's the other thing about these concessions. It's like, yo, where's the black list of request demands that initiate the concessions that are being? So you're going to define our struggle for us. You're going to define our oppression. You're going to define our struggle. Then you're going to define the concessions that you're going to give us on behalf of our struggle. Like, you're going to take all of the agency and authority and righteousness from? We're not going out like that. There's going to be some of us. There's probably going to be most of us who will comply to the concessions. There has to be a vanguard of people who walk in their own power, their own sovereignty and their own truth, who says, nah, I mean, you're not even going to insult me like that. You're not going to insult my children like that. You're not going to insult my future like that. And you're not going to insult our ancestors like that. You don't get to control that. Like, you're going to control my past, my present, my future, how we concede, how we fight. You're going to write all of the no self-respecting, dignified people allows that to happen. And we don't allow people who are protectors of that principality to have legitimacy, to have voice, or to have control over the way we seek black life. Liberation, independence, freedom, and empowerment. If you want to play Crispus Attucks, cool. Play it on their side. But don't come on this side trying to act like you speak for the voice of a people who sacrificed too much, who you've castigated and vilified. Now you act like you're going to be our ambassador and our champion. It does not work like that. Let's go to Shadu, line four. Greetings.
Yes, sir, my brother. My brother, how are you, sir?
I'm well, and yourself?
I'm excellent. And I'm also inspired, enlightened, and elevated by your presentation, by your research, by your continuity, by your focus, and by your clarity.
Thank you.
Absolutely. And I would actually like to just make a contribution As far as those of us who have reached the conclusion, especially men, particularly those black men who have come to the conclusion that they are ready to fight for our independent nationhood, our independent nation, those who have come to that conclusion, some of my suggestions are, number one, it doesn't take everybody in order for us to win a war. And also, one of the even preliminary things is to understand that this is a war. It's not a game. That's one of the things which I often repeat, because I think the use of the terminology game just brings everything down. This is not a game. We're not playing a game. It's a war. Our enemies look at it as a war, and we're looking at it as a game.
Right. Even at peace, there's low intensity warfare. There's psychological warfare that's going on. There's information warfare. They have been figuring out for 250+ to 400 years how to maintain dominance over us as a collective group of people. That is a war. We have been in one since we've encountered them, and they've encountered us on the shores of Africa. We just need to accept that.
Absolutely. And we need to respond to that, because once we accept it, then we can respond to it.
I see.
Now, if we're at war, then we must also have an enemy. The enemy also must be clear. If a person doesn't even know they have an enemy, there's no way the person will ever prepare for war.
I agree.
You have to clearly understand you do have an enemy. It's not all good.
And your enemy has collaborators, and his collaborators is where he draws most of his strength from. That is the thing I want us to understand. This thing, well, I don't care what you call it, racism, white supremacy, oppression, the list could go on, enslavement. No matter where it is a principality, it draws its power from our people's complicity with it. When you remove that, when you pull that away, this thing crumbles like a house of cards. The only reason it matters for us is because we give it our energy. And because we give that our energy, we're not building our sovereignty. We're not building our nation. We're not feeding ourselves. We're not clothing ourselves. And therefore, that energy, that Kazi, is being drained by these vampires and hyenas and not put towards the building of who we need to be as a people.
Absolutely. Because white supremacy is only as strong as black complicity.
Can't get much clearer than that, my brother. I appreciate your call. I appreciate you joining us. I'm trying to get as many callers into conversation as I want to. I think we're on Jacob, line two. Greetings.
Hey, peace be unto you, brother Shomari.
Peace.
As much as can be after hearing about our brother Mo, WURD family, you know, I've already said the standard prayer because Mo, you know, always would tell you I'm a Muslim. And sometime he would get on me because he thought that I thought that he wasn't a Muslim. We just see things a little different, but that love is there. So to his family, you know, I hope that they hold on. One thing Mo used to say, he said, I'm a Muslim. The book of the Muslims is the Quran. In that book, Allah says, because I've been jumped on because when I get on the air sometime as a Muslim, I don't say Allah. I'll say the creator, or, you know, people get on me for that. Yeah, that brother never say Allah. But, you know, I don't even get into silliness like that because, again, you know, you're never going to please everybody. None of the prophets ever did it, not even Muhammad nor Jesus. Mm-hmm. None of them had all the people at any given time. But, you know, Allah says in that book, I give life and I give death. And I'll give you life again. So we leave that alone. But you spoke about that scripture, that Bible scripture. That's one of my favorites, that wickedness in high places, right? That's the end of that fight war against principalities and wickedness. That's why I'm...
And he says each time. It's not an or, it's an and. It's all of the above, man. We rumbling.
right. But it's a war, right? That's why I be saying we got to get the wickedness in high places. All you got to do is look at 1600... Pennsylvania Avenue. Now, if we can't see it, I can't help you to see if you can't see that.
That's interesting, Brother Jacob. I would consider, if I were to fixate there, I would put that at the level of principality. I don't think that's high place stuff. It's like our brothers and sisters who like Ia Kai called earlier, and people might not know what she was referencing. There's a group of Hungan and Mambos in Benin who actually did a voodoo ceremony to bring a curse upon America, the police force, and particularly their mistreatment of Africans over the last 200 plus years in the shores of America, right? That spiritual battle, like there's so many levels, spiritual, macro, material, the micro level. And we have not really as a people looked in the mirror and said, yo, we gonna rumble at any of those levels, let alone all of them.
Right. But here's Brother Wasette just said, what kind of God do you have, okay, that wouldn't know everything we talking about, right? My God tell me not a leaf falls from a tree in the creation without my knowledge, okay? So he got that covered. Every bad white man who ever did anything to harm another human being that they saw less than animal, I think my God got that on.
Why would you want parity with somebody who saw you as
that? I don't want no parity with nothing but what's real and what the truth is. Mm-hmm. I'm saying.
No, I wasn't saying you particularly. I heard that word used. It's an old word. It comes from the Urban League. That's what their equal sign symbol is, by the way. That's what I'm saying. Hold on for a second. I'm pulling it forward because it's important. Because that's, again, a certain kind of thing has been activated or reactivated. The protectors of the principalities are going back to the playbook of the protectors of the principalities. That's why I brought up the founding of the Urban League. We don't understand the context of all of that. It was founded, and these groups were created as protectors of the principalities. And so when you see this, that symbol is the equal sign. Nobody in their right mind as an African who's been oppressed under a system of white supremacy will want parity within or in that system. That dishonors our ancestors. It dishonors our legacy. We want sovereignty. And you better be glad we're righteous people who will seek righteous retribution. It's nothing less that we deserve for our history, for our present, and for our children's future. Anything less is a concession. We're not making that concession. We're not taking that knee.
I hear you. But look, all I'm saying, Shomari, is that I know that the Creator, whatever name you give him, didn't allow my African enslaved ancestors for 400 years to go through what they went through to become a black version of what everything
you
saw ugly in the white slave master.
Thank you, Jacob. That's a beautiful way of saying that, and I appreciate that terminology on it. Exactly. What he just said. Exactly. And anytime we would advocate for that as part of our struggle, we dishonor at a deep level. And that's why it has to be challenged and pushed back. There's no way that narrative can become a part of what we're pushing for, the sacrifices we're making as a black people. Can't let it happen. Hit us up at 214. I'm beating this and trying to say. Hit us up at 215-634-8065. Toll free 866-361-0900. The phone lines are kind of tight right now. We'll try to squeeze you in. And we'll talk with you after these messages.
If you want to start your morning with mindfulness, motivation, and inspiration, tune in to Daybreak with me, Halana, here on WURD Radio, Monday through Friday from 6 to 7 a.m. I'm a health and wellness coach with over 15 years' experience helping people to transform their lives. On the show, we talk health and wellness 360, from getting your mind right to getting your money right. So let's rise and shine together right here on WURDRadio.com, 96.1 FM, 900 on your AM dial, on Daybreak every morning.
This Black Music Month vignette is brought to you by Pico.
Philadelphia native Jill Scott took the airwaves by storm with the debut of her first album, Who is Jill Scott? Words and Sounds. The album's unique poetic storytelling, combined with her soulful sound, went platinum and earned her 6 Grammy nominations. Jill Scott is also a poet who credits Nikki Giovanni's writing as her introduction to the power of words. She released her own book, The Moments, The Minutes, The Hours, a collection of poetry in 2008. Jill Scott
has appeared in over 24 movies and television shows and founded the Blues Babe Foundation, a nonprofit serving youth in North Philadelphia and Camden. Word Radio celebrates Jill Scott for her contributions to Black music, literature, and the arts.
This Black Music Month vignette was brought to you by Pico, powering communities.
No fear, just facts.
This is WURD, independent Black media.
Hi, this is Councilmember Derek Green. For the last several weeks, Philadelphians have stood up for justice. As summer comes, we need to keep standing up for public health too. I was proud to see Philadelphians wear their masks as they raised their voices these last few weeks. We need to keep wearing our masks to protect our families, friends, and neighbors. My mask protects you, and your mask protects me. Mask up, Philly.
Groundings
with Brother Shomari.
Right now on Word Radio
and wordradio.com.
Superstition ain't the way, and definitely superstition is not. We're in a fight, y'all, where our major strategy seems to be to convince our opponent to stop punching instead of blocking the punches, countering the punches, or beating them to the punch. No wonder we get knocked out. I like that. That was probably one of my favorite Facebook posts from the last week. But I want to go back to my primer, because again, I'm trying to tell you what you're going to see, and you're going to see a coordinated attack. What I'm talking about and the way I'm saying it right now, you're going to see people rail against it. They're going to rail against it in the name of sexism, patriarchy, toxic masculinity, homophobia, multiculturalism. They're going to say I'm a racist. You heard it. You hear it today. It's everything that can be thrown against this conversation will be thrown against it. It's happened before. It happened to Malcolm. It happened to Marcus Garvey. It happened because there can't be a place for this. This conversation right here, you can't maintain a plantation when you have people on the plantation who have this ideation. The plantation gets a little shaky to maintain. So they got to deploy the protectors of the principalities to kind of calm everybody down. Friday, Fiddler, Toby, Mammy, they got to be deployed to change the tenor of the conversation. That baritone and that bass is a little too much. They got to get you speaking in a higher frequency to make everybody feel comfortable. So you're going to see a coordinated attack. You're going to see a coordinated attack against the image of the black man who speaks in this kind of voice. You're going to see him become vilified again, you know, turn back into that drug dealer that nobody could love, or the rapist, or the criminal. So I want to read it again because I want you to at least understand the machinations, the semiotic and semantic machinations that you will see happen in front of you. You're going to see it on your TV screens. You're going to hear it on your radio airwaves. You're going to hear a softening of the conversation now because you got to make room for everybody at the intersection, right? So you'll chant Black Lives Matter, but everything you do will be for all people. And you just hope that black people get a little special seasoning in the sauce. But it never will be purpose for the purpose of black power, a black sovereignty, a black nation building. Can't really have that conversation. Every time that conversation comes up, this principality coordinates an attack against it. A very strong, well-coordinated attack. Go back and understand what happened to Marcus Messiah Garvey. Heck, go back and understand what happened really to Booker T. Washington. You know, because we've allowed them to narrate him as an Uncle Tom. We don't understand. He was so potentially powerful. And even doing some work in allegiance on the issue of Pan-Africanism was part of the first Pan-African conference, not the Congress, but the conference in London that he went to. So much so that there are people who would propose that he was actually murdered, poisoned on his visit up in that Massachusetts area, that New York area. So we dealing with principalities that will do whatever they can to maintain their power. We have not yet committed ourselves to that same fortitude in reattaining, maintaining, and sustaining black power. A quick primer on upcoming deflections and distractions before we get back to the phone lines. The face of white racism and supremacy will become the redneck, the dead presidents, old monuments and statues, flags, Archie Bunker types, and the traditional Southern Klansmen. Deflecting from the role, the real role, and the real power of white culture, white liberals, white structures and white institutions in the proliferation and maintenance of white supremacy and racism. They're going to go to the background and push the foibles to the front. Number two, the face of the black victim or the sacrifice will venture away from the big black straight male buck, i.e. George Floyd, Mike Brown, and what that represented, and will become other ethnics, black bourgeois talking heads, LGBTQAI, immigrants, and maybe even white women. All the multicultural stuff will come to the fore as what we were quote-unquote really fighting for. And that quote-unquote toxic black man, that black buck, will disappear back to his role as the perpetual threat to American white supremacy. That the criminal, the gangster, the hoodlum, the thug, the rapist, the murderer, the drug addict, the drug dealer, the lazy good for nothing. He's going to become that monster again. His typical role that he got sold to in this society. You're going to see that happen. Be prepared and stay vigilant, for this is the trope, the playbook, that will allow others to reap the rewards of our sacrifice and look up in a few years and wonder why we're still stuck in the same superstition, like hamsters on that spinning wheel. When I get a chance, I'm going to do a little bit more with this, because they're going after symbols, and they have symbols right in front of our eyes that we sleep on. You know, anybody knows anything about me, I've done, you know, Aunt Jemima, and the name is as powerful as the image, by the way. The denigration of the name is as powerful as the image. Uncle Ben, all that stuff. But y'all can still have them with Colonel Sanders with KFC, even though he represents a Kentucky plantation colonel. right? A colonel dressed in the same kind of colonel configuration as the leaders of the Civil War on behalf of the South, the Confederacy. Yeah, okay. Stop playing with me. Or y'all going to still go buy Planters peanuts, right? Not knowing what the planter aristocracy that that little peanut symbolizes on the front of a planter's peanut jar. Do you know what a planter is? Again, we talk about the plantation. Plant simply means to fix in place, to put in place. A plantation is a colony. That's why you could drive all around and see plantations still everywhere. It's a colony. It's a colonial designation. Planter being one who sows seeds. So the Civil War is essentially a fight between two planters. The Southern gentry planter class, which is represented on that planter's box, that planter's peanut box, and the Northern industrial planters, represented by the factory owners. See, there are words that are in this culture that have deeper meaning when we understand the economics and the power behind it. So we need to go back and understand what a factory and the factoring process really meant, particularly as it related to our enslavement. We need to understand what a franchise really is, what a plantation really is, what the invisible hand behind the scenes in economics really is, because that hand ain't that invisible. It requires murder and assault, what they call primitive accumulation and naked dispossession, what it means to assume a ceteris paribus in any kind of economic or mathematical equation, all things remaining not equal but the same. So in other words, before I can model what I expect will be the outputs and the outcomes of this mathematical equation, I gotta assume that you will stay in your place, et ceteris paribus. They'll tell us that it means all things remaining equal. No, it means all things remaining the same. I have to assume your stagnation in order for me to build my empire. I got to make you believe that there's an invisible hand behind the price and supply and demand curve. That invisible hand, though, is an iron glove that's pulverizing you into place so that the industry and the supply chains and the machinations can move through you without resistance from you. So we talk about the idea of factories, but we don't understand the idea of the factory in the slave seasoning process. We don't understand that colonizers were given franchise rights to colonize certain aspects of the globe and to colonize certain peoples of the globe. They were given franchises. This country was built on a series of franchises that were given to people to come over and franchise, i.e. plant themselves in certain places. We're just the spoils of those franchising rights. Yeah, sounds familiar, like a McDonald's franchise. Your 50 states are franchises. They grew from franchise rights. So this culture still embodies the very settler colonial roots that it was founded on. And until you shake that, until you disrupt that, until you defeat that, we really are not moving anywhere. This is still a plantation society. There are still plantation societies all across the African continent, all across the Caribbean. There are still people with franchise rights right now. Y'all call them nation states, but there are owners of those nation states who still have the franchising rights and are still reaping billions from those rights right now. That's the top of that pyramid, y'all. Those are the people we don't even get the chance to see because we too fixated on Archie Bunker and Frank Rizzo and this other nonsense. We got a real rumble to win and fight on behalf of our children if they're going to be able to walk into sovereignty. Let's stop punking out and let's stop playing. Let's go to line one. B, Delaware, greetings.
Hello, Brother Shomari and Biana, Worldwide Word and Lomax family. Special kudos to Sarah Lomax Reese and you word producers and hosts who are keeping us informed, grounded and focused during the multiple American and world crises of a pandemic, social uprising, less than 3 months, bloodless fourth industrial revolution, and the largest wealth transfer in the history of the world, virus while we all sheltered in place. Word, family, and listeners, please get your membership. It's less than a quarter a day, and it keeps us appropriately informed rather than
Miss B, can I request a favor?
Yes.
I want you to go through your introductory statement that you just said, but I want you, because, like, there's a lot in what you just said, and I think that our, like, if our people just even understood what you just said, so can you just go through it? No, the whole thing is the fourth industrial revolution all under the cover of COVID, because I think Rick from Germany asked me a question earlier about what I think about COVID, and I think that what you just said embodies what my thinking is, but I don't want to assume that most people understood what you just laid out. It's a very cogent explanation of much of what we're enduring in the world right now, but I don't think black people are operating from that perspective.
Well, not only that, and I will go through it, but Shomari, every day this virus transforms itself. Its highest rate of deaths are in Chicago, large urban Afro-American centered culture. In some places, it manifests itself like this. It doesn't affect children. It does affect children. It didn't impact the areas where the demonstrators were. Now it does. They're using the cover of the pandemic to cover a wealth of sins. I'll do that piece quickly, but also I started with Brother Shomari and Brianna and the worldwide Word and Lomax families because, Shomari, we are family. I am you. You are me. I am because you are. But I got to... You keep us informed, grounded, and focused. I'm not sitting here shaking in my boots. I'm not scared to death. I know that there is something that is out there. And I want our best brains to find out what it is, what it means, and how we overcome it. We've got enough young people with the knowledge and technology to find that out with all that STEM and STEM training. What I said, the multiple American and worldwide. It's not just here. This is a worldwide nanotechnology crisis. We used to grow peaches in Georgia and ship them throughout the United States. We're now growing peaches in South America, and they will go where in the world they are needed for the best price. We now produce cars somewhere else in the world, and they go all over the world where they are needed in this nanotechnology. That is the new world order, our new reality. But it is the multiple American and world crisis of a pandemic, social uprising, a less than 3 months bloodless, operative word here, big caps, bloodless industrial revolution, and the largest wealth transfer in the history of the world.
There you go.
All justified by the presence of the virus while we sheltered in place. Word family, get your membership, please. I have to say, Brother Shomari, my and our deepest condolences to Brother Warrior Mo's family. And may we pour libations to nurture the flourishing of his spirit in and among our thoughts and our hearts. He will never be forgotten.
I say.
I'm sorry.
No, I was agreeing.
Principalities at a crossroads. 3 months they used the media to conduct a bloodless, but not one drop of blood shed except for the hundreds of thousands of lives lost worldwide in history. But to eke out the minimal removal of offensive iconology, we are dying rapid, regular, brutal, and violent deaths with a regularity that defies any sense of logic. When the world is watching, the world is now looking at America you said what happened in Benin spiritually. What is happening with people putting their bodies on the line across the globe to say to us, rise up. Shomari, you are on time and in line with what is needed of a warrior today, and you have a tribe. Those of us who fear dying will die multiple deaths. Warriors die one time. Time for some exposure of gatekeepers. And Shomari, we're past acceptance of what's going on. It's time to start removing these threats.
That's right.
We love you deeply.
It's keep time.
Doing what you are doing and keep us focused. You stay bold, you stay black, and you stay in the fight, baby, because you have a tribe.
Thank you, Miss B. It's time before we don't have time. It's really that simple. That's why it's time. Whatever you're sitting on and you're thinking, oh, this ain't the time, this ain't the right time, yo, you better bring that joint forward. Because I'm telling you right now, this restructuring, this reconstructing that they're doing, and they've done it before. You know, Miss B used the term Fourth Industrial Revolution. It depends on what clock you're using, but they've reconstructed and reformed before. But this one, I'm telling you, think about the world that your children, if you have children who are 10 or 20 and under, or the beautiful ones not yet born, think about the world that we're going to, that they're going to have to navigate if we don't regain our power, regain our sovereignty, and reorient the flow of this world. You're going to have artificiality all around you. You can't even appeal to the human capacity of human beings right now. They've told you they are immoral. Their science, their history books applaud their amorality as key to their ability to bring destruction to this globe and reap the profits from it. In order to be a capitalist, you have to be amoral, because the rule of capitalism is profit above everything at all costs. I don't care about the climate. I don't care about people. I don't care about the cost, as long as the profit justifies it. I don't care about unemployment. There's an amorality in what we celebrate as the ideal. I don't want no parody to that amorality. And I'm saying this is amorality that exists in the human capacity of the functioning of the culture that's in front of us. That is now becoming more artificial and digitized. What morality will there be for you to appeal to if we let the artificial take over the amoral? Your children, our children, won't stand a chance if we don't stand now. It's really that simple. Those are my last words. We're going up on commercial break. When we come back, phone lines are lit up. I'm going to just go right to our callers. Everybody going to have 2 minutes, and then we're going to close out this segment of Grounding. So talk to you after these messages.
Your child deserves to be educated in a safe learning environment. Southwest Leadership Academy Charter School is a tuition-free public school. Both our locations offer dual-gender environments with single-gender classrooms. Our students score in the top state testing percentile among area schools. Apply online at bit.ly/enrolls SLA in all caps. That's bit.ly/enroll SLA.
Be heard.
Be heard.
Want another way to join the conversation?
Follow us on social media
using the hashtag #OnWord.
Be heard.
Stay connected to Word Radio.
Independent Black Media. Want the latest in Word swag?
Check out the shop tab on wordradio.com. Hoodies, tees, and more in a variety of colors. The shop tab on wordradio.com. Show the world that you're all about black.
Talk Media.
Listen to Laborers Live.
We created the weekend. We created the 40-hour work week. We just want enough to feed our family, be able to send our children to college, and let our next generation do better than we did.
To people that might have forgot how important unionism is in this country like the United States. People now infringing on our 8-hour work day, trying to work people more than 8 hours without overtime, trying to work people without benefits. In the long run, everybody's getting fat paycheck except the worker. So this is really a wake-up call for America.
The struggle is continuous. Tune in to Laborers Live every Friday from 4 to 5 p.m. Sponsored by LESSET, the Laborers Employers Cooperation Education Trust of the Laborers District Council of Philadelphia and Vicinity.
Local 332, Sam Staten Jr. Business Manager. Local 57, Esteban Vera Business Manager. Local 135, Dan Woodall Jr. Business Manager. Local 413, James Harper Jr. Business Manager. The Laborers District Council, Ryan Boyer Business Manager. And Tony Staten, Executive Director of LESSET.
I ain't no better than you, and you ain't no better than me. But we all have something in common. We all are species, seeds of God's creation.
Tune in to Messages in the Music every Friday night with Joey T, midnight to 6 a.m. right here on WURD.
Groundings
with Brother Shomari
right now on Word Radio
and wordradio.com.
And welcome back to our final segment of Groundings. And again, if people want to reach out to me, every hour, what you do, what am I going to do? Hit me up at Brother Shomari at wordradio.com. You can hit me up at Brother Shomari at gmail.com, or you can go to bringblacklife.org. If you really want to, you know, do some work, hey, it's out here for you. Bringblacklife.org. Brother Shomari at gmail.com or Brother Shomari at WURDradio.com. All right, like I said, 2 minutes. We're going to go to our final callers of the day. Let's go to Maurice, Southwest Philly. Greetings.
Right. Rest in peace. Is that the same Brother Mo, the heavy accent?
Yes. Heavy,
oh
heavy.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let me get to my point. We talked last week real quick about them giving us something we didn't ask for. Same thing with the city council and the police commissioner giving us something we didn't ask for. We know that was her order. Ain't nothing happened last with that tear gas. That was all her. Somebody fell on their sword for her. We all know about city council coming up with these so-called rules and changes when they really didn't shift their money. They just redirected around and called it something else. You know, it's like somebody owe you $40, and then when you say, I need a 20, they holler, I got it for you, but you owe me 40. You know, I'm tired of trying to explain to white people on how we feel and wanting them to try to understand. One last quick example, I'm going to close with this. Tamara Edwards, the anchor of Channel 6 News, gave the story about the brother in Uniontown who said the police officer out the burning car. All the other shows said he was a hero. Even the white cop said she was a hero. But when I talked to her on the phone personally and asked her, why was you the only one saying, I'm so glad he did the right thing? Black people can't do the right thing. Only white people can be heroes. Check yourself, sister. I appreciate you taking my call like that, sister. But you got to dig what you said, because words mean a lot. And by you saying you glad he did the right thing wasn't the right thing to say, dig yourself. That's
all
what
right.
I want to say.
Protectors of principalities. Everybody has their role. We're supposed to fight against them. Some people have decided that their job is to protect them. We as black people need to become very clear about that, because that's going to be one of the things at the crossroads that causes us confusion. There are people who have our skin tone, but their consciousness is on the side of protecting the principalities instead of fighting against them. Our children's future is at stake. Our clarity is essential. Let's go to Bobby, line three.
Thank you for taking my call. I want to make a statement. With us knowing the history of the relationship between black people and the European or white people and all of the lies they taught us, you know, as far as religion, they tell us we're physically weaker and et cetera, the negativity that's ingrained in many of our minds, myself at one time. This is my question. How is it so easy to believe a media that is ran by the same white system to tell us that we are dying, we as a people are dying faster and a higher number than any other ethnicity, and when we are beginning to unleash the falsehood of the teaching? I don't get that. Plus, I don't see any biological, because I look at the scientific biological research and things of that nature. I don't see any calculations that would add up to that we as a people are the greatest. Here's my argument. My argument is that any time a human get into a physical sickness, they turn to black people and experiment on us first. Because many of the results have said that what black people have endured in suffering, most white people, male and female, would not even be able to endure half that level of intensity. So I'm not saying that this virus is not true, but if it is, it's intense. How is it the president of the United States has been everywhere since the virus? He refused to wear a mask and has yet not been reported.
That's a wonderful question. I think that's a wonderful question that we need to be asking ourselves. To answer the question you asked, how is it that we come to believe these things, it's an operative thing in communications and television called the suspension of disbelief. And what we don't do is ask ourselves, what is it that I have to not believe in order to be transported into the narrative that they're trying to sell me? My Bobby used to call it the American nigga factory. You got to understand the entertainment, the education. I add the religious and the social systems, the social support systems. And there's a narrative that all of them are telling that we have to decide that we don't want to disbelieve that about ourselves in order to be drawn into the narrative and participate. But this is Oz, man. And so in order to go on that journey that Dorothy goes on, she has to really unbelieve her own power. She has to unbelieve her own sovereignty. She has to unbelieve her own truth in order for the narration that Glinda the Good Witch sells her to take over and become her destiny, only to get to the end of the destiny and say, well, you had the power all along. Black people need to learn from that journey in Oz, because we keep suspending disbelief and we know better. We should know better. History has shown us that we have no win when we rely on the largesse or the morality or the sympathy or the empathy of white America. We never come out of that equation whole. Let's go to Zen, line 4. How you doing, sir?
Okay, I think we got two histories that we need to study. We got to study the history that we had before we came to America, and the history before America we have in America before the Europeans came over to this country. Then we have religion. We got the Christians. We got Islam. I think we need to step away from both of those, because they give us a morality that when we really get right down to it, the morality that we have, it don't help us. What we learn to be, when we learn to celebrate Christianity, that morality ain't done nothing for us. The same thing with Islam, that morality hasn't done anything for us, simply just by studying the history of the two religions. You can see, you wouldn't have been a Muslim unless they killed you to make you a Muslim. You wouldn't have been a Christian unless they enslaved you to be a Christian. They got you. They changed your name. They changed the way you eat. They changed the way you think and dress. If the people who look like me want to get in touch with God, look like they would try to get in touch with God from the way we did before we had anything to do with any other person other than somebody that looked like me.
That's if we were in our right mind.
If we can't touch God, if we can't get in touch with God from the black point of view and from the African point of view, then we got a problem.
Exactly.
We got to learn who God is for us, not from somebody else's religion or nationality. Who is God for a black or Asiatic black man?
Well, then we have a problem. I mean, that is the crux of the problem. That until we don't value our culture, our way, our essence enough to make that our priority. And so other people can write their priorities on us, and then we spin ourselves around like a whirling dervish trying to justify other people's scriptures written onto us, right? That scripture is the act of writing, scripting, right? So we reject our scribes, our comedic scribes, our historical scribes, such that other people can write their scriptures onto us. And that is the narrative we are now living out. And again, when you root your dream in the American dream, I'm telling you, Friday, Fiddler, Toby, that's the only place for the black man in the European mindset. And so most of us are taking a knee and showing our neck, and it symbolizes that we're complicit with the role of Friday Fiddler or Toby. Let's go to Imani, our last caller of the day. Greetings and good afternoon.
Afternoon, Brother Shomari. How are you doing?
Great, yourself.
I'm doing fantastic. Thank you, Jesus. Ups and downs, peaks and valleys, yet still holding on.
All right, we got about 90 seconds.
Okay, well, I'm want to say that we got to, in addition, be mindful about the KKK, but also the Nazis. Some say that they have strong relations and strong roots in this country towards people of color and brown people and women. And I say that we come together under the 99% under farmers, get back to the basics, the simple, you know, way of life that this country is founded on. We'll be better off, and we'll stop a lot of these diseases from non-GMO foods and stuff. So that's what I suggest. And also, if we can stop talking, okay, don't say that we on the chopping block, you know, on the auction block all the time. Why is it all about us all the time? You know, why can't we give our children gift certificates instead of talking about them like they, you know, inanimate objects, like it's, they're people, they need food. If conversation can't put food on the table and shoes on a baby's feet, what is this? Good for.
I agree, and there's no reason we can't, so let's start doing it. I thank you for your call, Imani. This closes out Grinders with Brother Shomari, all things et cetera paribus. I'll talk to you on Sunday at 6 o'clock. Peace.